start soon.
Okay, so where do you want me to go?
Some people eat it, they come later. Hey, good morning. Come and sit with us. Unless you want to hide behind the laptop.
Sorry?
Come and sit with us. Unless you want to hide behind the laptop.
You are from here?
From Brazil.
Vivian Mello. Vivenda. Yeah, that's her, yeah.
How are you?
10 o'clock.
Hello, good morning. Dzień dobry. My name is Stephanie Cassild, and it's my privilege and pleasure on behalf of the Research Committee 25 Language and Society of the International Sociological Association to welcome you here today. We are delighted to have you with us to participate and share in our Language and Society Research Advances in Social Sciences International Conference. This conference is co-organized with the UNESCO Janusz Korczak Chair, with the patronages of the Ministry of Science and Higher Education of the Republic of Poland, and the Research Committee 32 Women, Gender and Society of the International Sociological Association. I would like to especially underline the key role and tremendous work done by Professor Anna Odrowat-Kotz. She is the one who took the initiative in July 2018 to offer this wonderful opportunity. She is also the one who took care about having the most inclusive conference. She found the supports and the funding for us to have the most comfortable conference conditions. I also wish to especially thank to the rector of the university and to the Polish Commission for UNESCO, who provided support to Anna's initiative. RC25 warmly thanks Maria Grzegorzewska University for providing the conference venue and its facilities free of charge, which enables no registration fee for participants. Thank you for welcoming all of us at Maria Grzegorzewska University. I also would like to thank the keynote speaker for having accepted our invitation. Thank you all for sharing the knowledge you produced. That many of you have traveled long distances to be here serves as a reminder towards our scholarship just how important looking at language is. The Research Committee 25, Language and Society of the International Sociological Association, RC25, was established in 1968. About 15 to 20 years ago, the RC was at risk to be shut down due to the lack of members. Thanks to the leadership of Professor Céline Maria Pascal, who was our president for 2006 to 2014, the membership increased in size, gathering together scholars by the following epistemological insight: looking at language rather than solely through. This direction was continued and developed by Professor Amado Alarcón, who organized the first interim conference of RC25 outside of the International Sociological Association last year, with a focus on language at work. Thus, the Language and Society conference we are participating in together during these 2 days belongs to proceedings of a recent field. And the structure of the program applies our motto, looking at language rather than solely through, by focusing on the way your research looks at language. I hope the choice will challenge, excite, and inspire your scholarship. And before I hand over to Professor Anna Odrova-Skoltz, I want to say once more, on behalf of RC25 and the whole organization team, welcome. It's wonderful to see all you here.
Good morning. Thank you very much for coming to our conference. There'll be some more people arriving later for the sessions and the second half of the day. We had some indications of program changes, but they're only small program changes and they don't affect the timings that we have been given. The only confusing thing is that we are on lecture theater C, not in the lecture theater B as previously decided, but we have lots of space here. We can run and jump, and later on it will be very useful because at the end of the day we're going to experience some Polish folk dancing and singing, and we'll be able to learn one of the Polish folk dances with the instructor. So I hope that we will keep focused during the day on the scientific side of this conference, and I will not go on about the welcomings and the invitations and the thanks. I just need to officially thank you for coming from our rector, who did not come this morning because he's not very well, but he sends his best regards to all of us for the very fruitful conference. And I think it's a blessing, actually, because we would have a 20-minute extra of welcome and thank you. And this conference is really all about you and about your research and about all your research experiences. So I will not go on any further. I think after Professor Céline Marie Pascal's presentation, I will just give you a few technical suggestions for the day. But for now, I consider this conference open, and I thank very much Stephanie Casilde for organizing the conference with us, and Professor Céline Marie Pascal for coming to Poland all that way from far away continents. I know we have lots of guests from about 59 countries joining us during this conference today and tomorrow. So thank you very much for coming, and the floor is yours.
Dzień dobry. I'm very happy to be here. Thank you very much for the invitation to join you and to be part of this conference. I especially want to thank Anna and Stephanie for all of the work that they've done to organize this conference and bring us together. It's not a small task. I also want to give a special thanks to the university, the Maria Grzegorzewska University, for hosting us and for making it so easy to be here. And before I get started, I'd like to make a few other acknowledgments. One to Polish sociology generally. In the United States, we think of Florian Zunke as one of the people who shaped the epistemic foundations of the field, and so it's kind of exciting to be in Poland just for that reason. I also want to acknowledge that the, let me see if I can arrange my slides here. Oh, that's clever. There we go. So to go forward. There we go. All right. Success. So I want to acknowledge both the contributions of the International Sociology Association and RC25 Language and Society for their incredibly supportive work. Many sociologists around the world study language in some form and find that there's very little support in our home disciplines. And RC25 has over the years provided a place for us to not just exist, but to flourish, to find scholars doing work that's like ours, to develop an intellectual community that's international and also grounded in methodology. So thank you for that. And many thanks to UNESCO. I think that UNESCO's particular commitment to expressions, to freedom through expressions of freedom of speech and the development of peace worldwide are really important, and that it's my wish that the relationship between RC25 and UNESCO is a long-lasting one. It's very rich. Thank you. So as I get started, I want to acknowledge that today the world is facing a violent intensification of the scope and reach of rising authoritarian politics. So it's also happening at one of the most precarious times in history. Now more than ever, we have a need for a careful examination of the relationship between linguistic and material violence. This morning, I'm going to talk a little bit about some general terms. I'll define those and provide a global context. Then I'll go on to a presentation in which I focus on four facets of weaponized language that's being used by the far right. And I'll conclude with some effective means for engagement. I've left a little time for discussion at the end, so I hope that we'll be able to have, in this kind of a more intimate setting, some vibrant conversation about the rise of weaponized language around the globe. So to start, I want to define what I mean by weaponized language. I understand it as a rapid intensification of signifying practices that lay the essential cornerstones of material violence. Weaponized language concerns normalized expressions of hate, the use of slurs, and rationalizations for violence. But perhaps even more importantly, weaponized language shapes public discourse, public attitudes, opinion, and behavior. In the cases of Nazi Germany, Rwanda, and contemporary Myanmar, victims of ethnic cleansing were subjected to weaponized language for months or years before the regimes turned genocidal. Weaponized language is a systematic manipulation of emotion that amplifies resentments, deepens social divisions, and destroys the integrity of public communication spaces. The ensuing cycles of communicative chaos generated by weaponized language eventually extinguish desires for clarity and nuance, and when most effective, destroy the appetite for public debate.
Janis Berzin of the Latvian Military Academy describes weaponized language as a tactical shift from the direct annihilation of an opponent to promoting the opponent's inner decay. Some strategists call it full-spectrum warfare. Weaponized language strengthens authoritarian rule by making deliberative democracy impossible. Here, I want to pause and highlight four key characteristics of authoritarian movements, just to, again, keeping us on the same page. One is that they pursue a nostalgic quest for a mythological past when things were better. They seek some form of purity. It might be racial, religious, or national. And they develop this sense of purity by dehumanizing minority groups, which often comes with cultivating the belief that the dominant population is being victimized just by the presence of these minority groups. They elevate anti-intellectualism, and we see this in attacks on universities and on the college educated. And they destroy the integrity of public information, leaving people unsure of what to believe. Currently, there are rising authoritarian movements in more than 14 countries, and these movements align in various ways with an additional 30 countries that form the historical mainstay of authoritarian regimes. Here's a list, an abbreviated list, of countries with rising authoritarian movements. Many of us find ourselves here. There may be more continuity in these times than we'd like to admit. Yet we must also acknowledge that there are some very important differences. This historical moment is quite different from the past in some very important ways. As we witness this authoritarian turn around the globe, numerous catastrophes loom in our futures. We face massive inequality, with 8 individuals holding an aggregate wealth equal to half of the global population. That's 3.5 billion people. In 2018, the United Nations High Commission on Refugees offered what it called a conservative estimate that 70.8 million people have been forcibly displaced. That's one in every 108 people on the planet. Best estimates suggest that the unfolding climate crisis alone will produce 200 million refugees by 2050. At this moment, 40,000 fires are burning in the Brazilian Amazon, and we have massive emissions of nuclear radiation from disasters, including Fukushima and Chernobyl. All of these threats transcend national boundaries and are leading people to wonder if we're coming upon a historical limit to our survival. Indeed, we may face a lethal absence of hope. In the precarity of this moment, we're witnessing the entrenchment of far-right authoritarian politics. As of this writing, much of the globe reacts with frustration to the hypocrisy, contradictions, and lies that are associated with this turn to the right. This moment demands that our attention and our critical engagement as scholars who study language, our insights into weaponized language are central to understanding the reach, nuance, and aims of authoritarianism, as well as to crafting effective means to interrupt and transform these right-wing movements. The weaponization of language today rests on a constellation of facets that include censorship, propaganda, disinformation, and mundane discourse. I'm going to take up each of these four facets and conclude by considering the unique intellectual space that sociological studies of language offer for addressing the communicative chaos and social chaos that's created by the right-wing movements and these discursive tactics. I believe that as scholars, none of us are naive about censorship. Governments, corporations, and religious groups have long overshadowed free speech. Fundamentally, censorship prohibits language that threatens hegemonic interests. Today, it flourishes in old and new ways. Entrenched prohibitions against specific forms of speech are easily identified. For example, in China, there are an estimated 2 million censors at work to police the internet and the online activity of users. Even so, the official who had been in charge of censorship in China, Liu Wei, denied that China censors internet content. It's a misuse of words if you say content censorship, he said. But no censorship does not mean that there is no management. In Russia, Igor Ashmanov, who has been called the shield and sword of Kremlin information policies, refers to the state control of information as information sovereignty. In the United States, the Trump administration in 2017 announced bans on a collection of words, terms, and some of these included evidence-based and science-based. So this is the premier national research institution on health was formally banned from using evidence-based and science-based in their reporting. And the administration claims this is not a ban, but any papers that are produced that use these words get sent back without being read. So while all censorship is shocking, to restrain the Premier Health Research Institute from using the words evidence-based and science-based reduces credible research to being one of many points of view. And while we are all entitled to our point of view, we are not entitled to our own facts. George Orwell is credited with warning that the farther a world drifts from the truth, the more it will hate those who speak it. And we see this both in science and in news reporting. Trump has called both the press and individual journalists enemies of the people and ordered the government to collect information on reporters and news media, as well as on individuals who post information on social media platforms. In Hungary, Prime Minister Viktor Orban's regime collects detailed information about journalists, as well as about media advertising and editorial content. In the Philippines, President Rodrigo Duterte has called reporters spies. Increasingly, in these hostile environments, journalists face death threats, kidnapping, physical assaults, and doxing. History is full of instances in which those who spoke the truth were felt to be more threatening to the state than actual enemies. In the last 2 years, 276 journalists and media workers have been killed, and it should be said that 90% of these murders go unresolved. Reporters Without Borders just added the United States to the list of most dangerous places in the world for reporters to work because of a mass shooting at a newspaper that left 5 reporters dead. In addition, journalists are increasingly subject to arrest when reporting news that governments want to censor. In 2018, 348 reporters were detained in connection with their reporting activities. I say detained, but we know what it means to be detained, right? I'm detained if I'm running late for a bus, but this is a different use of that word. We're seeing governments impose an unbearable and disproportionate cost on reporters and media workers. At the same time, we're seeing public spheres flooded with propaganda and disinformation. Propaganda, even at its most basic level, is more than a rhetoric of persuasion. It's a strategic mix of selective facts and fiction blended to promote a particular point of view. And in this sense, it's always a persuasive project based on deceit. When audiences recognize something, some part of that information as being true, they're much more likely to believe the other pieces that are unknown as also being true. They seem more plausible. Propaganda campaigns drive elections, lead us into wars, shape our entertainment, affect our consumer patterns, and infiltrate our values. Propaganda's sole task is to shape desires and dispositions. Sigmund Freud's nephew, Edward Bernays, used Freud's theories to develop propaganda, which in the US we call public relations. Initially, Bernays used propaganda in order to compel people to buy products that they didn't need. But he went on to use propaganda to push back on all forms of regulation and to make free market capitalism synonymous with democracy. Bernays' propaganda machine was so effective that it inspired Joseph Goebbels, the Reich Minister of Propaganda in Nazi Germany. What a claim to fame, right? Victor Klemperer argued that with constant exposure over time, propaganda becomes a language that thinks for you. and I want to call historical methods of propaganda, propaganda 1.0. This includes the use of slogans, the repetition of catchphrases, the cultivation of strong emotions, and the use of easily understood symbols. I'm sure all of this is recognizable to you. In the 20th century, propaganda took on a new form, what I want to call propaganda 2.0. The best example of this is what's known as the tobacco strategy. The US tobacco industry hired a public relations firm known as Hill & Knowlton to create a propaganda campaign to obstruct prevailing scientific knowledge that linked smoking to cancer. Their goal was to create doubt about the existing science and thereby dispel public concerns and delay legislation. The scale of their effort is important. To sabotage scientific knowledge, they hired researchers, they created their own scientific journals, and they created their own scientific societies. So let that sink in for a moment, right? They're the researchers, the journals, it's this production of a legitimized form of false information. The strategy was so successful that in the United States, the tobacco industry faced 50 years of lawsuits without any significant loss. And as a result, the United States government was not able to legislate any regulation against tobacco as an addictive and carcinogenic drug until 2009, and that's almost 60 years after the evidence emerged. But this captures only a very small part of the tobacco industry success. Today, tobacco remains unregulated in much of the world. Tobacco use kills more than 7 million people worldwide every year. The tobacco industry continues to be profitable at the cost of human health, and the practice of spreading ignorance has been central to achieving this goal. Given this level of success, the tobacco industry strategy has been adopted by oil companies, the nuclear industry, chemical and agrochemical companies, and all in an effort to discredit scientific findings. So this regards the depletion of the ozone, acid rain, nuclear radiation, herbicides, and the climate crisis. The Institute for Strategic Dialogue has identified this same strategy among right-wing extremist groups that are using pseudoscience, distorted statistics, and social media to promote research and news media, to promote the fear that white people are under threat around the globe. If the public trust in scientific research and news media has never been completely rewarded, it has also never been more violated. Technology as an accelerant acts as an accelerant for all forms of weaponized language. So this brings us to what I'm calling, for lack of a better term, propaganda 3.0, which is a weapons-grade computational propaganda. It was devised by the military, and it's now being used by governments, business, and movements. Computational propaganda is a suite of tools that includes automated social media accounts, algorithmic gaming of social media platforms, and artificial intelligence. These tools analyze the online profiles of users in order to identify and then target audiences with tailor-made content that speaks to their hopes, their fears, and their biases. Cambridge Analytica bragged that it had 5,000 data points on every single voter in the United States, and that it was able to affect the 2016 presidential election by leveraging these data points. Here I should say that I understand disinformation as false information that spreads systematically. This isn't about someone making an error, but it's an intentional effort to confuse people or mislead them. In this sense, it functions as a subset of propaganda. Disinformation campaigns provoke reactionary responses that sustain epidemics of social unrest. Stalin coined the word disinformatia in 1923. It's used today to consolidate power by exploiting cultural vulnerabilities. Recently, researchers have documented that Russia's many efforts to affect elections in the United States included posts and ads that stoked racism. And as you look around the globe today, consider how cultural divides are being exacerbated. Disinformation strikes at the very foundations of democratic society as publics increasingly lose their capacity to tell truth from fiction. In the 21st century, disinformation campaigns include the systematic production of fake news panics, conspiracy theories, misleading information, and lies. So fake news panics reshape reality as leaders attack people, media, and information that they want to discredit. For example, Syrian President Bashar Assad when told that 13,000 people had been killed at one of his military prisons, responded, "You can forge anything these days. We are living in a fake news era." A state official in Myanmar recently told media, "There's no such thing as Rohingya. It is fake news." And Spain's foreign minister, when presented with photos documenting police violence against Catalonians, responded, "Fake news." As is evident in these examples, the charge of fake news is levied to deny what is verifiably true. Consequently, the charge of fake news functions as a very specific form of signifier, one most closely associated with Joseph Stalin's efforts to consolidate power by denying specific realities, such as massacres, and to attack people who spoke of realities that he didn't want to acknowledge. Today, world leaders use the charge of fake news to discredit challenges to power, to attack free speech, and to undermine human rights. Fake news panics destabilize publics even when the public can see through them. Just weeks after taking office, Trump aligned himself with the strategies of Stalin, Hitler, and Mao when he declared, the fake media is the opposition party. The fake media is the enemy of the American people. Disinformation campaigns are also rife with conspiracy theories. In 2018, Hungarian Prime Minister Viktor Orban forced the closing of the Central European University, a private university funded by George Soros, an American of Hungarian and Jewish origin. Orban, who has promised to defend his Christian homeland, claimed that the CEU was a part of a plan by Soros to flood Hungary with non-Christian immigrants. In the US, QAnon, is a far-right conspiracy group that supports Donald Trump. In 2016, they circulated rumors that Hillary Clinton was running a pedophilia ring from a pizzeria in the basement of this pizzeria in Washington, D.C. And on one hand, it might be hard not to laugh at the absurdity that Clinton was running a pedophilia ring from a pizzeria. On the other hand, this conspiracy theory led to a shooting when a young man armed with an automatic weapon arrived at the pizzeria to attempt a rescue of the children. 1 week later, a poll found that nearly half of Trump voters gave some credence to these rumors that there was indeed a pedophilia ring. To paraphrase Voltaire, those who can make you believe absurdities can make you commit atrocities. In India, at least 30 people were murdered in a single year after being identified on WhatsApp as child lifters. 5 people in India who were accused of being sex traffickers on WhatsApp were murdered by vigilante mobs. WhatsApp, owned by Facebook, is an encrypted instant messaging and phone service with 1.5 billion users. And while the size of the user groups is limited to 262 addresses, encryption makes it impossible to share those and to have any idea of where when you share them, you have no idea where they've come from when you receive them. So the internet and the proliferation of mobile devices has accelerated and intensified the disinformation campaign. In 2017, Twitter's automated systems caught on average more than 3.2 million suspicious accounts per week, and that was more than double from the year before. Facebook reported removing 2.2 billion fake accounts in the first quarter of 2019. Disinformation campaigns online are powerful, effective, and inexpensive. They're very efficient ways to create political and social chaos. Lies and misinformation are, of course, central to this work of disinformation. Sadly, I can say that the US president serves as something as a case study in lying. It's been difficult to keep up with him even for this presentation. He's now on record of having made over 10,000 publicly documented false statements in just over 800 days. This is overwhelming and unmanageable for mainstream media as well as for individuals. Even fact checkers who professionally follow Trump are having trouble keeping up. Given the volume of lies, it becomes clear precisely why recommendations to confront lies by verifying truthful information are both important and bound to fail. Liars have seemingly unlimited options. So to paraphrase Montaigne, if falsehood, like truth, had but one face, we could then take for certain whatever was the opposite of what the liar tells us. But the reverse of truth is a boundless field. Systematic deceit functions as a form of violence that leverages reasonable expectations of truthfulness to coerce and compel people to act in ways that are quite different than they would choose if they had correct information. Truth and politics have never been on the best of terms, but we have entered new territory. It isn't only the number of lies that pose a threat. Consider that when ordinary people lie, we orient toward the truth in order to make our lies seem plausible. We want our lies to be seen as being true. That's the nature of deceit. Ordinary people craft lies with an eye to preventing ourselves from being discovered as having lied. This is not the case for Trump, whose lies are not masked. He openly bragged about lying to the Canadian Prime Minister about trade deficits. Trump is not trying to get away with a lie. In what has become known as Sharpiegate, he tried to mislead the nation for an entire week about the path of Hurricane Dorian. The administration used a Sharpie marker to alter an outdated storm projection from a National Weather Service. Even after he had been corrected, he pressed forward with this lie and threatened to fire anyone at the National Weather Service who contradicted him. We laugh, of course, but it's truly frightening. Trump's lies convey an impression that he can say whatever he wants and the world just has to take it. To the extent that he seems to have impunity, it's because he does not stand alone. He's part of a comprehensive system that brought him to power and has ensured his survival. Even when media identify lies, there is some significant part of the population that doesn't seem to care. Indeed, he's part of a cohort of world leaders who adopt a very similar approach. Trump's communication has been successful even while those of us wedded to facts might disagree. Efforts to demonstrate the falsity of claims are always important and always inadequate. This is precisely why we must be paying attention to the use of language, not just matters of fact. Disinformation and propaganda working together do more than to create factions and tensions between them. They place factual reality at risk. The greatest danger is not that truth will be accepted, that truth will be defamed and lies will be accepted, but the sense by which we take our bearings in the world is being destroyed. Reality itself becomes less objectively real. Reasoned debate is replaced by emotional spectacles. The effects of censorship, propaganda, and disinformation most powerfully manifest in mundane discourse. In the case of weaponized language, mundane discourse might be best understood as a linguistic delivery system, a device through which weaponized language enters the mainstream. Public discourse can be like tiny doses of arsenic that appear to have no effect when initially swallowed, but which are highly toxic over time. Weaponized language is a powerful form of symbolic violence that tills the soil for physical violence. Among the horrific acts of violence this year was the massacre in Christchurch, New Zealand. Shooters entered Al Noor Mosque and the Linwood Islamic Community Center, killing 51 people and injuring 59. The Institute for Strategic Dialogue identified 10 Twitter accounts that were most influential in propagating the idea that white people are under attack. 8 of these were in France. 1 belonged to the extreme right, a website called Defend Europa, and the other belonged to Donald Trump. Trump's Twitter account has been identified by the Institute of Strategic Dialogue as one of the 10 most influential accounts for propagating the extreme right-wing paranoia that white people are being eliminated through migration and violence. The United States has gone so far as to create a denaturalization task force to revoke the citizenship of naturalized citizens. Trump's anti-Muslim, anti-Latino hate speech has been directly correlated with increased hate crimes against Muslims and Latinos in the United States. Weaponized language precedes and accompanies every act of collective violence. Mundane discourse normalizes weaponized language. As I wrote this, tens of thousands of children from Central America are being warehoused in the United States without access to parents or guardians. Many children are lost in a bureaucratic system of detention. Over 49,000 unaccompanied children, most of them from El Salvador, Honduras, and Guatemala, have been apprehended and jailed in horrible conditions by the United States at the Mexico border. Such attacks on children have been made possible by the very intentional linguistic practices that preceded these actions. We come to see the world as we have learned to name it. The nationalism that far-right movements seek depends on the routine use of slurs to construct groups of people as being less than human, as being threats to so-called good society. For example, in the United States, the term illegal alien is now commonly used in place of asylum seeker, refugee, or immigrant to dehumanize migrants. Through media and public discourse, weaponized language shapes our thinking. People casually talk about chain migration rather than family reunification. Hate's being mainstreamed into public discourse through euphemisms and rebranding. We've seen it with Marine Le Pen's rebranding of the National Front in France, and we see it as well when white supremacists call themselves the alt-right, as if they were a legitimate party with a platform beyond white nationalism. This rebranding is strategically imprecise. It allows a wide range of social groups to join under other pretenses, all the while retaining the organization's unchanged core of white nationalism. We see this as well in Poland when Kaczynski, leader of Poland's Law and Justice Party, proclaims that LGBT ideology is an imported threat to Polish identity and to the existence of the Polish state, and pushes to make cities and provinces LGBT free. Groups who around the globe now call themselves conservatives to justify hatred toward other religious groups, racialized groups, as well as LGBT, bisexual, transgendered people. If we adopt weaponized language, regardless of our intent, we become complicit in normalizing hate. It's critical that we confront this language and refuse to incorporate it into our own. Public discourse is always significant, it is always strategic, even if we don't fully understand it. These four facets of weaponized language, censorship, propaganda, disinformation, and mundane discourse, are intended to overwhelm publics and debilitate engagement. We can see how weaponized language functions as a tactical shift that promotes the inner decay of democratic systems. We are caught in a spider's web in which it is difficult to face the world around us and dangerous to look away. It's important to remember that when we face the world, we have an opportunity to make a difference. We can choose to live with radical hope, the courageous belief that collective good can and will emerge from the actions that we take. The weaponization of language is not new, yet we now face a dangerous acceleration and intensification of those processes. To paraphrase Chinese artist and dissident Ai Weiwei, we do not face an information crisis, a refugee crisis, or a climate crisis. Much more fundamentally, we face a human crisis. We as scholars have an opportunity to step into this moment. We have the capacity to make a difference, and this is exactly why scholars in critical disciplines, including gender studies, critical race studies, and more generally social sciences, are facing increased attacks by governments. Open attacks on disciplines that teach critical thinking are part of right-wing movements that attack civil society around the world. Importantly, there are many scholars and activists, intellectuals, who are engaged in various forms of challenge to these movements, and I believe we will hear from some of these in the conference in the next 2 days. Global circumstances would seem to invite the social sciences in general and sociologists in particular to fight back by entrenching ourselves in the world of objective facts. This path is important and perhaps irresistible when politicians and media openly make statements that are certifiably false. However, a retrenchment in empiricism will not deliver us from this moment any more than it could prevent it from arriving. Sociological studies of systems of signification are essential. The moment calls for a complicated analytical response. As George Lakoff so clearly demonstrated, when we negate a frame, we evoke a frame. We cannot simply refute what is happening. Critical analyses of authoritarian discourses will give us a roadmap to where these movements intend to take us and how they intend to do it. Systems of signification are not epiphenomenal to culture. These are processes through which culture is created, maintained, and transformed. Critical sociological engagement with systems of signification offers us a way to decode and interrupt far-right movements as they rise before they become fully entrenched, and to decode them once they are entrenched. Sociological analyses of systems of signification will enable us to identify and critique efforts to normalize specific forms of violence. They also lessen the likelihood that discursive strategies will be naively recirculated in media and mundane discourse, and they will provide counter-discourses that could prove to be an effective form of resistance. The conditions for peace and violence are created and made meaningful through systems of signification. It is through systems of signification that we create, locate, or abdicate our responsibilities for action. Our work as scholars is more important than ever. So I thank you and welcome your comments, questions.
Just for practical reason, I will circulate the microphone so we can hear the questions. We have about 20 to 30 minutes to engage with our top expert on language and linguistic sociology. So please use this opportunity.
And if you might like to come down closer to actually have a conversation among ourselves, I really invite you to do that, to think of this as a community of scholars with something to investigate.
Anyone? Question?
Hi there. Basha Vucic, UCL. I just wanted to ask how much academia, for example, in the US, I know what UCL's sort of coping with at the moment in the UK, but how much academia looks towards its own role that it played in eugenics, for example, and how much of that was processed and worked through in creating some of the issues that we face with racialized ideas and side of things. I suppose it's the academia's role and the universities. I think there was 300 plus universities who had eugenics departments in the US,
yeah.
And we had the best one in London, so quite proudly. Yeah, so we're dealing only now with that history and legacy in London, and I'm just wondering about what your response is about academia's responsibility.
Thank you. That's a terrific question and a wonderful observation.
Can you hear me? Do I? Yeah. So an important observation. In the United States, universities are implicated in all of this, not only through these, you know, there was this historical moment of eugenics, but more fundamentally, the entire foundation of universities worldwide is based on a colonial imposition, an epistemic violence, and colonization of the mind, right? So when we think about universities, we can't assume that intellectuals that inhabit them or the structures themselves have a commitment to a liberatory project. We have to recognize that the systems that we're working in are themselves corrupted by a colonial process that was never meant for anyone except the wealthiest of white men, right? And that every time we think of tenure processes and we look at how women wanting to have families, how it affects their careers, when we think about women and men who have come from any place in the globe that isn't white, are marginalized both in learning and in scholarship. We think about the funding and the structure of departments. There's no place, you know, for many years, much of the premier universities in the United States were funded by slave trade. There's nowhere we can look and say, oh, you know, my hands are clean here. So it's really about locating ourselves within a critical decolonization process that has to be epistemic as well as more practically liberatory. Did I? Yeah.
Any more questions?
So for practicality reasons, I'm on this side. Thank you very much. In this very interesting process that you have described of the rise of authoritarian movements, are there any hints that these movements are linked to specific features of language, such as languages that distinguish between tú and vous, tú and usted? What patterns can be observed that link that aspect of language to rising authoritarianism?
Thank you. So to clarify, I'm not a linguist, so I'm not at all capable of answering the specifics of that question. What I study is more a sociological lens toward the use of language, so mundane discourse, how the use of slurs becomes normalized and what the consequences of that might be. How the right wing deploys euphemisms in order to broaden the net of appeal, that sort of thing. So I'm sorry, I think that's an important question, but it's one that I'm not able to address.
Yeah. Hi, hello. Okay, I'm sorry, I didn't move this. Hello, my name is Michalina Grzelka, State University of New York at Albany. And obviously, I love being a scholar, but at the same time, I'm very critical of the state of academia, especially in the United States. And I have noticed that American universities are failing not only their students, but also the public. And therefore, I'm wondering if there is any way in which at least American universities can regain this public trust that they have lost at some point, and I cannot pinpoint when they exactly lost that trust, but I can see that the public, and what you mentioned in your lecture as well, that the public is very, currently, the general public is very wary of people who are educated, who have college education, or also of scholars. And I'm just wondering if you see any ways in which universities can gain and regain that trust with public again.
Great question, thank you. I want to answer that, and I realized that I was amiss here. Is there anyone here who is a linguist who might be able to answer this question that I was not able to address?
Number one comes from a country where there is no
Thank you very much. And so back to your question, which I think is a really important one. I think academia at this particular moment is caught between competing discourses, right? So you have this the groups on the far right who are saying, oh, it's elitist, we don't like universities, we don't like intellectuals, they denigrate scholarship, and that's a very serious threat to academia. And that gets referred to as a lack of public trust very often. Mm-hmm. You know, those academics think they're better than everyone else. I came from a family that was not college educated, didn't have a high school education, and it seemed that every book I read became a brick in a wall between me and my mm-hmm. family until I learned how to take it apart. Because that's a long-standing point of view. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, you also have scholars who are trying to be responsible to a history that is less than just, mm-hmm. right? That is tainted. So these efforts to become more accountable to systems of oppression that are embedded within an academic system, I think, are not denigrating intellectualism and not betraying public trust, but that we face these two very different forms of critique about academia at this historical moment. And what I really am trying to do in all of my work is to take apart epistemic foundations, how it is we think we know the world, what can be known about the world, and how we do that. And then to be able to use that to create public good, right? And we do that by, in my mind, being accountable not only to others, but to ourselves for the kind of people we want to be in the world. Because too often, academics become disassociated from their own emotional life, their own sense of being one of many. And I think that's a pretty profound piece of identity to reclaim. Mm-hmm. Did I answer your question?
Yes, and also I would like just to add, what, like, do you think that the language that scholars use is also alienating in a way to general public? So do you think that we should start using, a slightly different language in speaking with, when we try to disseminate our findings, et cetera?
Yes, well, so that's a really important question, and I think it's a debate that hopefully will never be answered completely, but will continue. When I started a doctoral program, I was already in my 40s. So I had a long life before then, and I arrived at this place where language felt like a wall that was built to keep people like me out. And I spent a lot of time arguing, you know, with faculty about, you know, why do you have to say it that way? You could say it this other way. But only after some time, I realized that language is a tool, like any other tool. So we use a teaspoon when we want to put sugar in our coffee, but we need a shovel or a hammer to do other kinds of work. If all we have is a teaspoon, it's not going to be so easy to do construction, right? So we need to be able to have a variety of tools, and if we think of academic jargon as a kind of tool that enables scholars to speak in shorthand to one another, then fantastic. We can be really productive and then remember to translate later. But the difficulty is that once we become immersed in that language, it's hard to break out. So in my first book, all of the scholars said, oh, this is so clear, it's so, anybody could read this book. And my friends and family said, when are you going to write something we can read? You know, this is, you know, so it is, I think it has to be a struggle that lives within each of us and that we try to address personally and that we bring it into a broader conversation to keep that an active part of our conversation.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Okay, my name is Erzsébet Barát. I come from the University of Szeged, Hungary, and as a part-timer from the Central European University in Budapest. So thank you very much for this thought-provoking talk. And I would like to continue in a way where you came to with the point that you arrived at. In other words, when you talk about the importance of critical thinking and critical research, okay, I understand that as being able to assume different perspectives. That kind of responds to your concern as well, I think. But this being able to assume different perspectives entails just as much persuasion as there is going on, for instance, in the populist, radical, right-wing political discourse these days. So in other words, there's a lot of reasoning going on there too, except it's a different kind of logic, it's a different kind of reasoning. And what I see different in it is how much they are working on affect. And therefore, what I would like to ask is, like, how do you take emotions as products, if you wish, signified effects, into consideration when doing research? For this democratic purpose, if you wish, like for the disclosure or deconstruction of the epistemes that you disagree with.
All right, thank you. So you have a lot packed in. You have a couple of statements that I might disagree with, leading to a question that I could answer. So let me first say, I think of critical scholarship as engaging with relations of power. That it's not so much just having different points of view, but it is an active counter-hegemonic engagement with relations of power. Jargon, it's back, right? So that's definitely where I start. Then in terms of, movements, right-wing movements really cultivate emotional reactions. Because when we are reactive, we're not thoughtful. Most of us, unless you have been raised in a household that has some form of meditation practice that enables you some distance between your sense of self and your emotions, feel like you are one and the same with your emotions, right? That when you are really sad or angry or happy, that is the experience of yourself. It's not like you have a self having these emotions. And that's what the right wing really capitalizes on, right? Is that if they can provoke emotions, they don't have to have good reasons. They don't have to have logical anything, right? It is that emotional piece. So to the question statement about whether or not we are addressing that as a discourse, I think that we can deconstruct that, but I would not advocate for creating an effective reactive response in return. But I am on the margins of my discipline because I really advocate for a four-letter word that nobody in academia ever wants to hear, and that is love. Right? That if we think about the power of love in how we do our work and how we engage in our research, when I sit down to interview someone, so I've just conducted a year's worth of field work, and when I talk with people, if I can't find a place to relate to them in a compassionate and caring way, I can't really hear what they're saying. I get in my own way, right? So I think that if you're going to create an emotional, and I don't mean like gooey love, like, oh, you know, but, you know, that kind of profound agape compassion for life. From that place, that's the only place in which understanding is really possible. Otherwise, we project, right? So.
Thank you. So it's another kind of affect, I would say. It's another kind of emotional position.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Okay, we have another question here from Dr. Shineria Lillian Ockham from Calabar University in Nigeria. She asked me to read it for you. should we always see the weaponization of language as endangering complexities or monstrosities of harm? Could it have a binary effect on the positive side, even if it dies, if it does appear so in popular view? So could it have a binary effect on the positive side, even if it does appear so in popular view, that it endangers complexities or monstrosities of harm?
Please forgive my accents. My question is, should we always see the weaponization of language as engendering, you know, begetting complexities and monstrosities always of harm? Could it have a binary effect on the opposite side, even if it does not, you know, appear so in popular view? Then Trump will not be our example.
Thank you very much for being willing to read it. Your accent is no more problematic than my own. So I appreciate that. I think that language is productive, and it doesn't need to be productive in a negative. But what my concern is right now is with this weaponization of language and how it's being used, how we are being recruited into normalizing a politics of hate at phenomenal speed that is destroying democratic systems. So in that way, it's focused on the negative, but absolutely, you could focus on the positive. I wouldn't be my mother's daughter then.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, can you hear me, Kalin?
I can.
Thank you for your presentation. Well, I'm wondering, I don't know if you are right now writing a book, something like that, about this presentation. But my question is, you are basically, and mostly in this presentation, talking about right wing, yeah? Do you hear me?
A little bit louder, please.
Yeah, you are basically talking about right wing, yeah. But in the academia and in... It's fun. Yeah, thank you. We in Spanish language say, and I think that there is a translation, that there is the la superioridad moral de la izquierda, the left moral superiority. Yeah. Okay. Therefore, I don't know if you are considering these two sides of the token. Yeah. On one side, these discourses and from the right, yeah, and how they communicate, comparing them with this moral superiority of the left, mm, in historic terms, or at least in a lot of very important communication media and in several scientific spaces, like in sociology or philosophy, maybe not in economy, or a few of them. But my question is about that,
okay,
right and left, and if you are considering to this weaponization in terms not only of right, but also thinking about left.
Thank you. Parties. So just to be clear, in terms of moral superiority, I would only claim that for sociologists studying language. So, no. Seriously, I think that this. Whenever we find binaries, we know we're in a false language to begin with, right? Because the world doesn't exist in binaries, and that there are erasures being produced through that codification. So certainly, we have known worlds in our own histories in which the left was so far left it was right, right? And so there's not that clear distinction. My interest in this kind of scholarship is really to look at the kind of violence that's existing and the violence that I fear is coming to us. And the confusion, the mental confusion that's being agitated and exacerbated by the discourses on the right. So absolutely, I mean, you can turn on any, if you want to think of left, right,
news media and you can see inflammatory language and that sort of thing. But this movement toward unaccountable power, right? So the image that I gave of Trump doing the weather forecast, how ridiculous, right? How petty. It's a storm. The hurricane is coming, right? But on the other hand, to be able to do that, the capacity to hold forth with that sort of blatant lie and to threaten to fire anyone who contradicts you, that's a really different moment than what you see on the left-wing news media that are, you know, stirring something, right? So my concern at this moment is helping myself first to come to clarity about the circumstances in which we are living, because the climate crisis is real. We're in it. We have lost half of all species already. So the amount of upheaval that's going to happen in people's lives, 200 million people having to leave, being displaced because of climate alone. You can argue whether Syria is a climate crisis or a political crisis or a combination of them. This kind of displacement is profound and made especially problematic right now by the discourses on the right. So that's my concern. I'm not trying to take a position of being on the left or the right, but as a scholar studying the language.
But my comment is more in, I agree with you, when in the case, in example of Obama, yeah, because we are talking, we have heard about Trump, yeah, but I remember that Obama won the Nobel Prize in of peace, yeah. I remember 1 year after, or something like that, after he becomes president of the United States, yeah? And I think that this is interesting to put into the analysis, yeah? These two presidential figures, yeah?
Right.
How they are considered by press, or their influence, and the what Obama really did for peace and all that, yeah?
Right.
And they are in the left or in the right. It's only a reflection.
As always, Amado, I really appreciate your reflection. I think you're absolutely correct. There is a bit of irony here in that Obama receives a peace prize and has created more drone bombings than anyone in history, had the worst immigration policies globally, did not have a very good effect at all. So a lot of what brought that shine to his administration was the rhetoric of hope that he brought, right? Not the actual policies. He did more to destroy personal privacy and the internet than anybody else, right? Well, George W. Bush, you know, started it. But so I want to say I recognize that. But here again, I want to ask you not to think in terms of left and right, but this is kind of the reality of politics. There is no one coming to save us. We are not going to be able to say that the hope is coming from the left to save us from the right or the right. You know, like, there is no one but us in the room, because politics, if we're talking about academia being a corrupt institution, we have to look at the society we have built.
Okay, we have time for one last question, and the microphone goes to...
Okay. Hello, everybody.
Take two questions.
Okay. I'm concerned about new generation, in fact, because before we are researcher or lecturer at the university, we are parents. And my question is, in which way we can distract this dehumanization, And what you suggest for schools and teachers to change this situation? Thank you.
Thank you for your question. And I have to say that I'm not a scholar who studies education, and I am not a parent. So I feel poorly equipped to answer your question directly. But I can say I have met someone who has raised a brilliant human being. Her name is Rachel Hughes, and I encourage you to talk with her afterward because she might have some ideas about how to do it. If I wanted to know anything about it, I would go to her.
Thank you for this extra question time. My name is Nora Schleicher from Budapest Metropolitan University, and thank you for this wonderful presentation. What I've been wondering about is, why is it that these strategies that you described are so very effective, seems to be working so well? And I was thinking that perhaps we could add perhaps one more aspect to your 4 points, which might explain their effectiveness, and that is the information overload that we are surrounded with, that people are so much overloaded that what comes across in this chaos is the extreme, the emotional, the absurd even, or something that gets repeated and repeated and repeated again. So perhaps, and these are the aspects that you described as well. So could it be that this effectiveness of these strategies that were not unknown before are so effective now because we are surrounded by that much noise?
Yes, absolutely. I think you're absolutely right, Nora. The internet has been weaponized itself, right? And when we think about how it kind of invades our personal spaces, there is a way in which we are more vulnerable to information overload, to disinformation, to propaganda, to censorship. All of that has been intensified to an extraordinary level. And absolutely, the overwhelm is a very intentional strategy and a very effective one. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. If I may, I would like to take 5 minutes of your time to do some practical announcements, starting with the one regarding the updated program of the conference that is available on the Language, Discourse, and Society website. I'll show you where so that we all find it on our phones or laptops or whatever we have with us. And take this opportunity to thank very much Maud, who actually is the guru for the RC25 website and updates all the important information very promptly. And we find it the easiest way through this ISO website that then go on to, this is the process. If you follow the process, then you'll know how to do it. Then you click this, and then you're into the kingdom of Maud or the queendom. And there you will find, one moment, internet's slow. Okay, then you will find under the conferences, our conference, Language and Society Research Advances in Social Sciences. And then, if you go down a little bit, there is the program. So let's download it for now, just to quickly remind everyone what's next. And we are scheduled for a short coffee break, which we take here. I hope that we won't be unknown to each other, that we now be able to introduce one another to each other. We have time till 11:40, and at 11:40 we start 2 sessions. One of the sessions will take place on the ground floor of Building A, the building that is right next to the Szczęśliwicka Road. That's the eldest building in this university, built in 1922 as the eldest pedagogical unit in Poland, and the one who, first time in history of Poland, thought about people with disabilities. Our patron, Maria Grzegorzewska, was the precursor of special education in Poland, and that's why we have 1 session there just to
like leave the history and immerse in the history of this university. So this is on the ground floor. There is a poster of our conference on the door, so you'll be able to identify it rather quickly. The second session will take place here. Do not move too much. And then we have time till 1 o'clock. At 1 o'clock, we go to lunch. Lunch will be sandwiches and salads that will be served in film bar that is on the same floor that we are in now, in the same building. We will guide you to it. It's near the elevators. So there is the bar where we can have lunch. And then at 1400 hours, Professor Vivian de Mello Resende from Brazil, who is already with us, and thank you very much for coming for the full session, for the full day. We'll talk about metaphors in the representation of public policies. And then we will have a short video link with Dr. Kamalini Mukherjee from India. Unfortunately, she did not get a visa approved in time. And I'm very embarrassed about this on behalf of Polish Embassy, if you can hear me. So I do apologize, but she'll be linking with us via a video link with her presentation. This is something that we learned about very late. So there's no change in the program, just different method. And then we will move on to sessions 3, 4, and 5. We will move to building A again. There are two rooms next to each other that will be identified by the poster. And I think we can move to the Senate Hall from here because it's just a very nice room and we can show off what a nice room we have. So that's the plan. I also want to tell you before we take the coffee break that there are publication opportunities at this conference. I want to thank three participating journals, of course, Language, Discourse, and Society, run by RC25 of ESA, and Society Register, published by Adam Mickiewicz University in Poznań, and also International Journal of Pedagogy, Innovation, and New Technologies. We have a plan to index this conference at the Web of Science database, and for that purpose, we plan to release the first publication in January 2019. Publication will be with Society Register, and the deadline for submissions will be the end of October, so quite short notice. However, if you can't manage at that deadline, there is a very long deadline for submissions for Language, Discourse, and Society for the special issue that will be published in June 2021. So there's a time here. Also, if you choose, because maybe your topic is more relevant to this journal, you can also choose International Journal of Pedagogy, Innovation, and New Technologies that can consider your paper for December or June issue, depending when you send it. But I would like to ask you, if possible, to prioritize this October deadline for Society Register because it will really help us to put the indexation for Web of Science forwards in good time. So I think these are all the announcements that I wanted to make. Thank you for being patient and listening to me. Now please help yourself to fruit and coffee and tea. We're doing the ecological thing to not have too many plastic cups. So if you need to wash your cup, there is a restroom at the end of this corridor. And also by the elevators, there's more restrooms on each floor. Thank you. He didn't come. He is tomorrow. His poster is here, but I don't think he will come. Really? Yeah, that's the one.
he's not coming, but he sent his abstract, and he was very specific how much money I need to send him for it. I was just waiting for like something different. Okay, we're waiting for Professor Vivienne. I'm sure she'll be with us shortly because she's in the building. Okay, we're just waiting for Professor Vivienne de Mello-Resende, who will be with us very shortly because she's in the building, but maybe needs a little bit more time to prepare. But that's okay. Okay, just to confuse everyone even further, I will talk about the next sessions. We decided to scrap room number 1070, and for the session which is meant to be 1070, we will stay here. So it's just the Senators Hall, this room, and room 1069. So just sorry to keep changing the venues, but we're almost there.
It's up to you. You're the star. We are your slaves. Okay. You tell me. We can move this. Move it, yeah?
I will be here. Yeah? It's easier. Yeah. Okay. Yes, since I need to be next to this machine.
Okay. Good.
It's here. Vivienne
I will introduce you. That's okay?
Yes, yeah? Of course.
And then we start. And you have a lot of time because Kamalini sent us 8:70 video.
Yes, so I will use only 30 minutes.
Okay, so then we have some questions and then we play Kamalini's video.
Yes. Okay. This is good like that, right?
Can I open it on a big screen?
Oh, yes.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the next keynote speaker session. I would like to introduce someone very special for this field, Professor Vivian de Mello Resende from Universidad of Brasilia from Brazil. Thank you very much, Professor, for accepting our invitation to come to Warsaw all that way from so far away to share your wisdom with us. Thank you very much. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Is it working well like this? Yes, do you hear me? Yeah? Well, first of all, I thank you, Anna, for this presentation. And also I need to thank very much Professor Anna Odrovas-Coates. She is the shareholder of Janusz Korczak UNESCO Chair. And in her person, I also thank very much this University Maria Grzegorzewska for receiving us this week very well. We've been working here since Monday, right? I've been working here since Monday, but there are a group of women working here all this month in the summer school. So I want to thank all of them too for the opportunity of reading some, not reading really, but talking to them about their interesting papers, about the interesting work they are doing here in the summer school. It's been a pleasure to work with you. And I also would like to thank Dr. Stephanie Casildo, the president of Research Committee Language and Society from ISA, the RC25, for co-organizing this conference along with Anna. And for you, I would thank all of you for being here this afternoon too, after lunchtime. it's not easy to be here right now, right? So I thank you for being here. I prepared a paper provoked by the invitation of Anna and Stephanie. I prepared a paper for this occasion. I changed the title a little bit, as you can see. It's not exactly the same as you have in the program. It's due to the ways I decided to give to this discussion today. I should tell you first that I have been for 15 years or so now carrying researches around the topic of homelessness on the basis of critical discourse studies and more recently also the decolonial thought. In several research projects, of course, I've been studying, for example, Brazilian popular literature, literatura de cordel, also carrying research along with social movements like the National Social Movement of Street Children in my country and the National Movement of Homeless Population, and also carrying research about street papers in Portuguese language produced in Brazil and also in Portugal. These street papers are members of the International Network of Street Papers. And more recently, I do research on representation in mainstream news media, electronic web media, journalism. So I will talk to you a little about this actual research project I am carrying. But before, I need to tell you a little about decolonial thought, coloniality, and decoloniality. The decolonial studies define the European invasions in the American continent during the end of the 15th century as the milestone of modernity. The modern colonial world system thus highlights the dependence between the wealth concentration that rendered modernity possible in Europe and the over-exploitation of native and racialized populations in the South. Understanding the interdependence between coloniality and modernity favors not only a better understanding of the past, but also of the present, because it allows us to see how the colonial past extends to the current era. Silvia Federici sheds light on the simultaneity between witch hunts in Europe, the privatization of productive lands, and the bloody cold against people experiencing homelessness or begging in England, the colonization of territories and the extermination of American populations, and the beginning of human trafficking in the South Atlantic. All this paved the way for the institution of capitalism and the sedimentation of practices that support this mode of production and its relations. For Quijano, Aníbal Quijano, coloniality is the constitutive element of capitalist power because colonial relations involved the imposition of an ethnic racial classification of the world's population as a cornerstone for said pattern of power, which operates on material and subjective planes, realms, and dimensions of social existence. Social and gendered relations are also profoundly impacted in the early colonial modernity period, since it is when labor is monetized and the female is disqualified. Silvia Federici explains, based on historical studies, that the preferred discourse of exalting poverty used by church, such as in preaching about Lazarus or scriptures by Matthew, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. This discourse becomes radically transformed during this same period. New lenses to view poverty and begging give birth to the idea of the poor deserving help. According to Federici, this meant, in practice, that help would now be given only to the deserving poor, that is, to the impoverished members of the nobility, and not to those begging in the streets or at city gates. The latter were increasingly looked upon with suspicions as guilty of laziness or fraud. A discourse of poverty criminalization was carefully constructed since then and remains central to the order of class relations to this day. Federici collected, for example, two testimonies from the 17th century in which men belonging to the bourgeoisie declared their discomfort with the misery of others. A Venetian man wrote that, "You cannot walk down a street or stop in a square without multitudes surrounding you to beg for charity. You see hunger written on their faces, their eyes like gemless rings, the wretchedness of their bodies with skins shaped only by bones." And a Bergamo doctor recorded the aversion and terror engendered by an infuriated multitude of half-dead, harassing people on the streets, in the squares, in churches, on the doorsteps of their homes, making life intolerable in addition to the filthy stench that emanates from them and the constant spectacle of the dying. Yes. The first shelters for poor were created during this same time. They were workplaces that can be seen as persecutors to both public welfare shelters and prisons with disciplinary role. Due to this inheritance of suffering and death caused by the enclosure of productive lands in Europe and the ensuing famine wars, the racialization, enslavement, and extermination of populations in the South, the misogyny inherited from Europe. Due to this inheritance, when regarding modernity, one has to resist the optimistic narratives about creativity, communication, and freedom that relativize the suffering of thousands in the world. We often repeat very biased interpretations of modernity as if they were neutral. Amina Mama questions that being the African continent, the geographical location where globalization imprinted its most perverse effects, it is hard to understand why in some of the great texts about globalization, serious attention is hardly given to this continent built by 55 nations and more than 800 million people. All also critical of universalizing and celebratory representations of modernity, Grossfogel contemplates that modernity is not an emancipation process, although it can be shown as such when seen from above the abyssal lines. From below, one observes a system of death. The abyssal lines allude to the metaphor created by sociologist Boaventura de Souza Santos in order to refer to the radical marginalization of human groups that him excluded from the condition of humanity. In that respect, Mogobe Ramos explained that the dogma of neoliberal globalization of contemporary economics leans towards the marginalization of the other, in this case, especially the other human being. This orientation towards the marginalization of the other is fundamentally and practically the negation of exteriority. Denying another's exteriority is ontologically equivalent to denying their existence. It is like killing them. Through discourse, the other is constructed as inexistent or unimportant. That is why Patricia Hill Collins recognizes the role of ideology in this process, when arguing that racist and sexist ideologies both share the common feature of treating dominated groups, the others, as objects lacking full human subjectivity. Maldonado Torres argues that what defines coloniality of being is the active production of the other as inexistent. Recalling Franz Fanon, Maldonado Torres investigates the meaning of the damné and concludes that the damné is the subject who appears in a world marked by coloniality of being. The damné, as Fanon has written, does not demonstrate resistance in the eyes of the dominant groups. The damné is also invisible or excessively visible. According to Ramos, the gaze metaphor also serves to think coloniality through the difference between being seen or being detected. Native Amerindian and African populations, he says, were not seen by Europeans. Rather, they were detected as an instrument of wealth. We still remain unseen, states Ramos, regarding the African continent in the realm of international politics. But in national contexts, in political and personal levels, there are social groups that remain unseen. People experiencing homelessness are not seen, but are always detected as a problem. For this reason, the matter of visibility is relevant for thinking the homelessness situation, either invisible to public policies and social sensitivity, or excessively visible to repressive force and social judgment. With the main the purpose of examining the representation of the electronic media in news about people experiencing homelessness, the research group I coordinate in the Center for Studies of Language and Society at the University of Brasilia conducted a documental investigation that included discourse analysis with the help of a software for qualitative data analysis. Based on keywords typed in the search engine of three newspapers' websites, more than 750 texts were mapped and collected. Texts about the population experiencing homelessness, published during a three-year period. From Folha de São Paulo, we collected 456 texts published in this considered interval. The software tools were useful for thematic classification of the collected texts, for the perception of patterns and representational recurrences in these texts, for analyzing images that compose the news, and for the broadening mapping of metaphors present in this corpus. The software chosen for this study does not conduct automatic analysis, as it is a qualitative tool. Thus, reading of all texts was required and their codification were performed manually. In the process of the Folha de São Paulo data codification, some opinion articles in sequences of texts and answers regarding a specific territory, the San Francisco Square, were identified. This square is located in the central region of the city, near to the Law School of the University of São Paulo. The controversy surrounding these texts is a specific chapter in this corpus, led by legal professionals, one prosecutor, and two lawyers. So I will talk to you today very briefly about this particular chapter I am calling so in this corpus. This is composed by four texts published in 2 weeks about the homeless situation and also about public policies in the panel Trends and Debates, that is an opinion column of participative journalism in Folha de São Paulo. In this panel, texts are submitted by the audience in a specific form, which encloses an invitation to join the newspapers and informs readers that the signed article published do not represent the newspaper's opinion. The first text from this series is signed by two lawyers and entitled The Owners of the San Francisco Square. This title indicates the text is above all constructed based upon the metaphor of the homeless situation as the private appropriation of public space. Grounded on this argument, the authors express their views against the distribution of food in the streets. Also, they question investments in urban cleaning services in that region, and they defend policies that induce the use of city shelters by homeless people. The answer of the prosecutors, the prosecutor of São Paulo, comes 2 days later. In this text, the prosecutor asserts the unfamiliarity of both lawyers with the complexity of the homeless situation, and position himself against the elitist outlook of the two authors, who according to him undermine freedom without offering satisfactory public policies proposal. The following week, a third text, signed by the pair of lawyers, issues their response to the prosecutor. They produce a very metaphorical text in which they represent the homeless situation as a somber prison, a moral and psychological cage, in their words, suggesting that people experiencing homelessness should be disciplined in shelters. At the end of the text, they require the prosecutor's project. The prosecutor's answer comes a week later, claiming that shelters are not a complete solution for the homeless situation, accusing both lawyers of seeking merely applause, and moreover, upholding that one should not propose any project for the homeless situation without listening to thousands of people who experience it, that is, recognizing them as epistemic subjects. The four texts are in many ways related, for example, in games of answers and language exercises. In a short analytical stretch, I considered only two categories, metaphor and representation of social actors. I freely drink from both categories according to the needs of my data. In order to manage the metaphor category, I appropriated the proposal by Shorter is Black by manually mapping the metaphors about the homeless situation, also about the population experiencing homelessness, and about public policies towards this population. Then these metaphorical expressions were grouped into conceptual metaphors and conceptual keys. Following Shutter is Black, conceptual metaphors and conceptual keys are abstract inferences from linguistic evidence provided by particular metaphors. The purpose of inferring conceptual metaphors from surface metaphors is to identify interrelated patterns from metaphors that explain their meaning. Likewise, interrelating conceptual metaphors through the identification of conceptual keys may help evaluate the coherence of particular discourses following Tushart's Black. He adds that the identification and description of these conceptual levels increases our understanding of its ideological role. Thus, Charteris Black supports the argument of analytical economy when defending the advantage of considering several particular metaphors, that is, the metaphorical linguistic expressions, in reference to a smaller number of conceptual metaphors and an even smaller number of conceptual keys. That's his model. This table now displayed shows the 15 conceptual metaphors extracted from 49 metaphorical expressions mapped in the four texts. In the text, the written text I prepared, I analyzed the four texts. But due to limits of time and also limits of your patience, I will focus only the first one today. Metaphors about population experiencing homelessness in the first texts of the series are mostly about the territory, since people facing homelessness are metaphorically represented as the owners of the street. Public space being represented as a private territory leads to representing the population experiencing homelessness as usurpers of that territory. The square then can be referred as plots, properties, open-air guest houses, and people facing homelessness can be referred to as owners of San Francisco Square. Any intervention of social sectors for the benefit of the population experiencing homelessness is proscripted through its metaphorical representation. For example, donations bury individuals in the situation they find themselves in, or donors feed the homeless situation. The solution then is to demobilize the masses, which can be read as rendering them immobile by restricting their freedom of movement in the city. This interpretation is consistent with the territorial focus of the homeless situation in this text. Certain movements are represented as needing to be limited in the name of the freedom of movement of other populations. In order to justify this perspective, they build a scene. And thus, the beginning of the text is organized into space-time relationships associated with actions in which the population facing homelessness is represented by aggregation and abstraction. According to the authors, this illustrates the routine of one of the most important places in the history of São Paulo, which directs the focal point as at a place and not at people's lives, since it's not about the routine of a population, but a routine of a place. For the authors, the most despairing of all is witnessing this reality evolving along the prosecutor's office, the Department of Public Security, the Court of Justice, and City Hall, which again leaves no doubt about the territorial lens emphasized to address the topic of homelessness. The metaphor of the homeless situation as property serves to mask the fundamental contradiction of this text. Realizing their own contradiction and anticipating answers, the authors recognize that the world seemed cold and cruel. As for the representation of social actors, the first text of this series represents people facing homelessness by the metaphor of the owners of the square, as I already told you, and also by various aggregation structures. Around 30 people add up to 50 or so, an enormous contingent, dozens of people. These structures annihilate individuality because this type of representation does not recognize subjectivity. The representation of the population experiencing homelessness in this text also occur through objectification in assimilation with garbage and waste, reinforced by spatial metaphors like build up and agglomeration. The juxtaposition of garbage and waste with human beings builds identity, which leads to a negative evaluation of the population experiencing homelessness, as well as its objectification. Dehumanizing representations are the rule in journalism written about the homeless situation, and that is why meanings such as those expressed by the pair of lawyers who initiated this debate are often unnoticed. People facing homelessness often cease to be perceived as people. In terms of Rameau's, they are not seen, but detected. That's not an exclusivity of Brazilian press, I guess. And that's not an exclusivity of homeless population, neither. So we can think about the representation of migrants these days, for example, in Europe. Well, the citizenship ideology is often invoked in an effort to deny CDUs to certain groups. Opposition against social groups regarded as uncivilized is unemployed in order to validate segregation, forced displacement, and the restriction of their freedom. The revanchist city turns it back against segments of the population whose right to the city is seen as unthinkable nonsense. They can only be perceived as usurpers of spaces belonging to other groups. These meanings are certainly questionable by the logic of equity, but naturalized and expressed without shame. Regarding human rights, humanity, and equity, Rameau reminds us that human beings have equal value with respect to their humanity. In the more formal sense, no single human being has a right to life that is superior or exclusive regarding other human beings. Because of scarcity, rules of distribution must be formulated and observed in order to satisfy each and every individual's claims to the right to life. Without such regulations, the most powerful or astute of the individuals will be able to satisfy their claims to the right to life, but always in detriment of the weakest. Distributive justice therefore requires rules of distribution of the necessary resources for the maintenance of life, because the life of every individual is always of equal worth to any other human life. Seems obvious. For Rameau's, prioritizing the human being should be a basic ethical value, but the law, he states, is no longer a guardian of rights. It is the keeper of the duty of obedience to money, which is also expressed in ideologies that support privileges alongside poverty, abuse of excesses alongside scarcity. That is what justifies a focus on territory, when facing such suffering, negation, and the violation of human rights. Thank you. That's all.
So if you have some question for Viviani, I will circulate the microphone, and we will also keep minutes to for the projection of Camalini presentation, which will represent 8 minutes. So.
Thank you very much. It's very interesting. I wanted to make a remark. It's not really a question. Well, in fact, it may be a question as well. What do you think about the performativity of the efficiency of this representation on people? On readers of the newspaper. You know what I mean?
I'm not exactly.
Do you have elements?
What I think is,
do you have some elements about the efficiency of this kind of representations on the readers and people?
Okay. Well, I haven't carried reception research to give an account on effects it would be needed. But in this critical discourse studies, we understand that the relations between language and society are a particular and intimate one. This relation means that the representation of social problems in a certain way forms our understanding of these problems, and our understanding of the social problems are able to conform also the ways we will act upon this social problem. So if I read every day in the newspapers that people facing homelessness are individually responsible for their situation and that they are comparable to waste, for example, and that they are not willing to work, and things we read in newspapers about this population, if I read this every day, I will probably not be willing to commit myself to overcoming the problem, for example. I don't know if I answered your question. Did I answer your question?
No, I don't.
Do you want to comment?
It's very difficult to study reception of discourse, and maybe in this kind of situations, it would be possible to show the articles, your corpus, to your readers, and try to study their reactions.
Yeah,
but,
of course.
But of course, it's a long process.
Yeah, I haven't carried reception research, as I told you. But one thing, we must agree that there are something that in the basis of this, the fact that we perceive ourselves as human beings, with some rights to life, and these same rights to life that we are willing to ourselves, we aren't recognizing for other human beings, right? This is a fact. And I think, theoretically based in critical discourse studies, that discourse has something to do with this. But I am not caring reception research, as I told you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much for a wonderful talk, which brought back many things, like familiar, regarding the perception and the regime's strategies concerning homelessness in Hungary. So when you said, like, probably it's not the only thing, I mean, it's not just like in relation to refugees, but also like strategies and policies and politics of homelessness as well. What I would like to ask is a question also, and please sort of like say if I misrepresent the sort of like the conclusion of the talk, which would be like the if in a critical stance, okay, the criticism would be founded on some appeal to universal human rights against this kind of ideology of citizenship or citizenry. And my concern in this regard would be that, like, what kind of understanding of human rights would that be, which is different from the Enlightenment legacy, i.e. the modernist legacy, yeah, of an appeal to universal human rights. Mm-hmm. So it's like, who counts? So, you know, what kind of conceptualization of human rights that would be that is other than this modernist colonializing understanding of the human being?
Thank you. It's a very good question indeed. I recall Rameau's, Mogob Rameau's, because he expresses another way of understanding the relations between humans and also the relations between humans and other other things in the world, nature, for example. Mogob Rameau talks from the perspective of Ubuntu. I don't know if you know that. Ubuntu is a philosophy of the Bantu peoples in Africa. He is from South Africa, and he expresses this philosophy like that. I am because you are. I am possible as human being because we are all human beings together. I am possible as human being because this earth is together. So he's fundamentally, he's expressing Ubuntu. It's a traditional philosophy. It's not something Rameau's invented, but he's expressing this philosophy, is that we cannot be without being with others. So my human being, my human rights are in the exact measure as your human rights, because I cannot be complete without being complete with all the others. So what he is expressing is exactly that, alongside with modernity, what Europe brings to all the world and South America and Africa and as well, is a perception, a dualistic perception of everything. And in this dualistic perception, there isn't a room to the knowledge that, to the traditional knowledge that I cannot understand myself without being together with all the others. So it's a collective perception of being. It's not my human being, but it's not my human right. It's my human right can only be perceived alongside with the human rights of the others. So I am not recalling this okay. human right, modern human right, enlightenment discourse. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I am able to explain such things
in English.
Thank
you very much. No, I would translate it into something like a relational understanding of existence, right?
Yes.
But not an exclusionary.
Yes,
but
that's why Mogobi Rameau talks about the right to life. Mm-hmm. It's he discusses the human rights, and by this means, it's the essential right to be alive.
Thank you very much.
We have time for one more question, if anyone wants to ask a question. I'm sorry I ran out of the room, but I ran off the room, but Cavallini was on the phone for her session, and we were trying to establish a solid link, but it's too jittery, so I think we go with what we planned, and we just play her 8-minute presentation video from the laptop to not have the disturbance of connection. But we have time for one more question.
Arleta Suwalska, University of Łódź, Poland. I'm interested in policy of your country. I mean, about what kind of leading party in your country which uses ideology or set of ideologies could overcome or minimalize the problem of homelessness in your country, in Brazil. Mm. That's all.
We are now in a post-democratic period in my country. I don't know if you know that. But before, in the democratic period, we constructed some participatory policies, including for facing homelessness. In 2009, Lula, former president Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, established this, promulgated a law, It's a national policy for homeless population. And in this law is prescribed that this law would be construed in participatory committees, intersectional and participatory committees, paritary between people working to government and ministries and secretaries and people indicated by social movements, homeless people social movements, would not only construe this policy, but also monitor its functioning. And it was going just until 2018. The issue is that homelessness is a very complex situation. Very complex. It's not only about housing. It's not only about working. There is no simple answer. So a complex, necessary answer should be construed with people who has the experience of being homelessness, in homelessness. Thank you for your question. Thank you.
So, thank you very much for your very inspiring talk. I'm sorry I missed some of it, but I'm sure we will reflect when we put the little video together from the recording of the sessions. So I'll be able to listen intently to your talk later. I will now try to make Kamalini's speech work. It's very brief. And if any one of you have any questions to Kamalini, I will just take a note and we will send them to her and she will reply by messenger or on email to your questions. Sorry, the volume's not working. One moment. Maybe, I don't know. Is there anyone there behind the glass? No? Okay, need to go downstairs maybe.
Mostly to share my thoughts on my able to.
So I take the opportunity to make an advertisement for the forthcoming conference at Porto Alegre, because the deadline is less than a week. It's the 30th of September. And it's a very huge conference because it's about usually about 6,000 scholars coming. It will be in Porto Alegre from July 14 to July 18 of in 2020. Of course, there are a lot of research committee offering wonderful session, and I will insist on the program RC25 is offering for that conference. So please have a look at the program, and several sessions are offered, and you may find a very nice home to present your research at this occasion. So don't miss the deadline. It's the Monday, the 30th, and the last day are crowded, so take care of the deadline. So also just for the update, the session number 4, I guess, instead of moving on the ground floor, we'll stay in this room just in order to avoid too much, yes. And so the session 3 and 5 will respectively move in the ground floor and in the senatorial room.
The one in the middle of the table, there's like 3 sections. The middle one will stay here after Kamalini's talk, and the 1069 will happen where it was before downstairs, and I will take the session to Senators Hall personally. Okay. Are we ready? Okay.
And a very warm welcome to everyone present here today. I'm truly honored to be a part of this international conference and to have the opportunity to interact with so many amazing academics, scholars, and researchers.
Okay, it appears that the video is a bit corrupted because of the link that we had was poor quality, but the guys will try to make it as loud as possible. Okay. So we'll try again. Hope it works.
Mostly excited to share my thoughts on my paper today. My paper is titled Exploring.
Maybe we try to revise the video and we play it when we're sure that we can hear it, because now I'm holding you up and maybe you want some more coffee before the next session. Please help yourself. There's a second jug with hot water by the further table by the fruit. So you're welcome to refill, and then we move to our sessions. Session number 4, I suppose the one in the middle of the table, remains here. I will take people going to the Senators Hall, and there is a third session in the same room we were in on the bottom floor. Okay. 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 Perfect. Entry. Thank you for coming. Whilst you're setting up, I'll make a few announcements about the restaurant, maybe. Yeah.
Some people are already asking where it is and
okay.
Searching, but
I have printed out.
And then I will introduce you shortly to Jean-Louis.
Okay.
Later, so.
Okay. Okay. So.
Everybody is. It's amazing. It's a smooth conference.
I
Okay, whilst we're setting up, waiting for our keynote speaker to get ready, I would like to make an announcement. I have printed out the address of the restaurant for those people who are planning to join us for the Italian optional gala dinner tonight. The cost of participation is 100 zloty. It can also be paid in euros or dollars or pounds. And I have a menu and I have an address, but of course you'll be able to follow me because it's a 10-minute walk from here, so we can go as a group. So I will maybe distribute the address, and I suppose the easiest way is to pay on the entry, so we don't have to administer any receipts. Thank you. Okay, and for everyone who is planning or not planning go to Italian restaurant, I've forgotten to say, just a reminder, there'll be a sampler of Polish food in the bar filmowe. There'll be some very strange things like bread with smalets and gherkins and Polish pierogi, so you can try them before we go to the restaurant or decide not to if you find it a bit of an odd idea. And the children arrived, the folk group called Lazurki is preparing once we do our final keynote presentations. So how are we with time? I think we start in 1 minute, so if anyone needs to settle with some water or something, please do it now. I just need to inform you that we will be recording this session. We will make a short 7-minute video from the conference later on. So just so that you know, you can like, correct your hair and whatnot. And the folk group also will be recorded. So, okay, so we are 6:05. And I would like to introduce two keynote speakers that will talk for us tonight, and hopefully with us later on. Professor Derek Smith from University of San Francisco. Thank you so much for coming tonight. And Professor Jean-Louis Arcand. Sorry, I don't speak French, terrible pronunciation, but thank you very much, Professor, for coming all the way to Warsaw to join us at this conference. I see that lots of people got tired, such a long day, but I think it's very precious that we have this opportunity to speak to you in a small group later. So, Professor Derek Smith, may I ask you to come and present? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Anna. Good evening. Hello. it's been a long day for you, I understand. I had trouble getting here the other day, so I know what the long day feels like. I've been misspelling my name the last couple of days, so that means I'm tired. I'm from the United States. I work at the University of San Francisco. I am a professor of educational leadership. I train school principals and university administrators, both in the US and in Southeast Asia. I will be talking a little bit, very briefly. I want to keep myself on time, so I have a clock here, so I don't go over time. I have a very short amount of time to expose you to a very simple and practical form of discourse analysis that I often have to use in my work, both as a professor and as a consultant to the educators in my region. I'm going to be talking about what I'm loosely calling district equity policy. To put some context to this, the United States for many years, many generations, has had very dramatic racial disparities in health, wealth, and academic completion. And schools and school districts within our country still struggle with that to this day. This particular analysis is on a particular set of policies that were put forth by one very troubled district in a very famous international city. That's the only hint I will give you, that it's a very famous city. But we'll talk a little bit about the importance of this type of work when it comes to on-the-ground implementation of educational practices. I try not to talk too fast because sometimes I even lose myself. But I will try and keep at a decent pace. One of the things to understand about the district that I'm looking at, now remember, in the United States, schools are a part of what we call school districts. Those districts can be one school districts in small towns. They can be incredibly huge, like New York or Los Angeles, that might have upwards of 100,000, 200,000 students within them, okay? This particular district is a little bit smaller, roughly around 50,000. 40 to 50,000 students. It's a pretty old school district in the United States, established in 1851, with approximately 136 different schools. We have a substantial amount of English language learners, and the district has a very significant budget for a district in that area of the United States. Part of that is because there is an enormous amount of corporate contributions to this particular school district. However, for many years, it has struggled with the age-old problem of segregation. In the United States, the Civil Rights Movement in the middle part of the 20th century worked to legally end segregation in schools and integrate racial groups into the same schools after many years of Jim Crow policies. However, while that was legally done, other methods were used to continue to separate students based on race. This particular district, in 1978, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, a largely African-American and white group of activists and lawyers, came together to file a lawsuit against the district for segregation. By 1983, the U.S. District of Court approved a type of agreement between these parties called a consent decree. These are actually pretty common in the United States when the Supreme Court requires a particular institution to take certain steps to meet the parameters of the law. Okay, as you can see here, there were two main elements of this consent decree. One, to continue and accelerate efforts to achieve academic excellence for all students, and two, the elimination of racial and ethnic segregation throughout the schools. Does this make sense so far? Yeah. Okay, excellent. All right. Now, we had 1978, then we had 1983, okay? On 2005, the consent decree expired, and for the first time, the district was allowed to move forward. In 2009, it began a new policy to actually begin to solve separation of students by location, okay? Since 2010, the year before the current policy to actually bring students into the same schools. Now you gotta understand, this is over 40 years after the law required it. Since 2010, the year before the current policy went into effect, the number of the city's 115 public schools dominated by one race has climbed significantly. As you can see by the second bullet point, this particular city, which now has been exposed, this particular city has had its racial gap actually worsen over recent years. So this sets the context for the discourse analysis around equity agendas and equity policies within the district. The district has multiple policy steps authorized by the school board to make changes to this condition. What I chose to do was analyze a few different documents, and I'll skip to them and come back to that. These three particular documents were the documents I chose to analyze, to really look at some of the possible gaps and shortcomings of the existing policies to bridge the gap of segregation within the district. These are three critical documents that ground the district's current policy as we stand today for trying to address these issues. the school board resolution to establish what's called a safe and supportive schools policy, the 2016 to 2019 district-wide strategic plan, which is signed off by the superintendent of that district, and the larger county plan for expelled and at-risk youth, which is supposed to be in alignment with the state's laws. Now, I'm going to go back a bit so you can get a look at what this segregation actually looks like. This is the city in question. What you'll see on the left-hand side, the blue and green dots represent schools that have the lowest population of students that receive free or reduced lunch. This is a socioeconomic determination. For those of you familiar with the United States, that's how we gauge socioeconomic status. Students that make, whose families make below a certain amount of money received free or reduced charge lunch. The schools that have the fewest numbers, fewest percentage of those populations on the left, the schools that have the highest numbers of those populations are on the right. Okay. Unfortunately, this also corresponds with race in the United States, that most of the schools on the right are mostly Black and Latino students, including the continuation schools for students that struggled in traditional coursework. And on the left side are the more affluent families, mostly white and Chinese to be specific, not Asian, but Chinese to be specific. Our Pacific Islander students, Vietnamese students, and et cetera, would also be on the right-hand side. Okay. All right. So what were we looking at here? Okay. The Safe and Supportive Schools Initiative is incredibly important. I don't have time to go into all the details of it and show it to you. I would love to show it to you. We could all look at documents together. I think that'd be a very fun professorly thing to do. But I don't make my students do it on the screen, and I wouldn't make you do it on the screen either. But here is the district's major answer to this segregation as it currently stands. And I want to tell you why, actually, if I may. This is incredibly important here, okay? Oops, sorry. In 2012 and 13, African American students made up approximately 10% of the school district's population, but they accounted for close to 50% of suspensions and expulsions. This is a national trend in the United States, okay? And African American high school students missed an average of 19 more instructional days annually than their peers. Also, the district was tied for having the lowest performing African American students in the state, while simultaneously having some of the highest performing students of white and Asian backgrounds in the state. Interestingly enough, this school district actually tied with one of the poorest school districts in the state for their African American student performance. So, with that, their current policy initiatives moving forward merited some analysis. Am I making sense so far? Okay, great. So, for example, there are a few things that I was simply looking for, and I'll get to them in a second. But this is a pretty decent example of what the paragraphs tended to look like within the initiatives that I examined, okay? You can see, if you take time to read this long-winded English here, is that there are a few acronyms in there representing very popular initiatives for transforming school culture and climate in the United States, okay? You'll see SWPBIS, which is School-Wide Positive Behavior Intervention and Support. Has anybody ever heard of that before? Okay. What that is basically a tiered, structured way of addressing disciplinary issues. Students with the most severe disciplinary problems will experience the most one-on-one intensive response. The broad folks that do not tend to experience disciplinary transgressions are expected to receive broadline school-wide messaging, access to general school opportunities, and as more and more severe acting out occurs, the more focused and pinpointed your responses are. That's a positive behavior support model. And secondly, restorative practices actually comes from community activism. It's the idea that you work with communities to build bridges when transgressions occur, as opposed to going straight to exclusionary practices. So anyhow, why would I put up this particular paragraph? As you can see, that it has all the language necessary to address some of the most
critical social and psychological needs of students, okay? You'll see that they're talking about including trauma-informed practices that establish high behavior expectations of students in a bias-free and culturally competent school community, okay? It goes on later to say that these practices are specifically designed to create safe and supportive schools and to address the disproportionate suspension of African American and Latino students, as well as any other group of students that is disproportionately disciplined, okay? Now, there's something I want to go into regarding this, okay? The short story here is a couple of things. Throughout the documents, all three, you'll see these critical trends. One, a persistent pathologization of the student and the community, okay? The district language throughout all the documents are talking about providing support for students that are suffering, addressing needs that students for students that are suffering. The problem here is that it locates the issue of student misbehavior, student lack of performance, student lack of engagement within students and any other social ills that they occur, that may occur. The problem here is that American schools are very violent. American schools themselves can cause students to be disengaged. We have just over 800,000 reported victimizations a year in United States schools, with only 2% of students reporting that they've been victimized. We have one in every two students in the United States either being a victim of or witnessing a sexual harassment incident or assault on school campuses. Furthermore, students in the United States are more likely to be victimized on a school campus than off a school campus, ages 12 to 18. And perhaps even most importantly, no teacher in the United States nor school administrator in the United States is required to learn how to physically intervene upon physical transgressions, break up fights, or even process an actual disciplinary issue by student due process to receive their certification. None of these things are required to receive your certification in United States schools. Yet, the discourse around trying to improve student behavior through policy is focused on providing only needs support systems for students in need. I'll get into that a little bit more. Am I making sense so far? Okay? And in this construct, you'll see in the language, suspensions and disciplinary approaches as attempts, that's not, that two is not supposed to be there, sorry, as attempts to quote unquote adjust students' behavior, at least four times in one of the policy documents, well, three times in one document, once in another, you saw a constant mention of behavioral adjustment, so that suspensions, expulsions, alternative suspensions were about adjusting the student's behavior. Again, no mention at all to any school adjustments other than providing supports. I'm watching my time here. Also here, in this way, schools exclusively become the places to support healing, okay? But the community itself is not presented as a space of healing. The community and outside world is presented as a space is where students are experiencing psychological turmoil, and they come to school to somehow experience some great form of safety. But as I told you the statistics, that is not statistically accurate for many students in America. And by the way, schools are highly unnatural locations anyway. Who the heck wants to be in a place with 1,000 people of their exact same age group? I don't know, not me, but it's not a very unnatural environment. But what's also very important here is that there's no mention of the institutionalized discrimination that I outlined in the beginning. Again, this particular study is far more detailed and elaborate than what I can present in 20 minutes, but it's very important to understand this dynamic here, okay? Once you have a documented legal history of being out of the line of the law when it comes to institutional discrimination and harm to students, yet your policies for making change make no reference to that history. In my discipline of educational leadership, you are almost guaranteed to continue to perpetuate those flaws. because you are not interested in cultural transformation of your institution, but you are trying to use your flawed institution to transform individuals that just got there. Okay, some key missing pieces I just mentioned. There's a missing piece of the history and the culture of the institution, but also there's a total lack of professional framing of intervention and an exclusively programmatic framing in nature. Messed up the grammar there. Talked about discourse analysis. So this is incredibly important. At some point in our educational history, those of us who have our degrees, many of us in the room, professors, folks in higher education, we began discussing interventions for human beings as programmatic interventions, exclusively. So now when students collectively or in a particular demographic are experiencing a hardship, we go into meeting rooms and try to design a programmatic intervention for what is occurring in a school climate in the immediacy. Okay? That is not a bad idea. However, it's incomplete. This is what I'm finding throughout this district. Okay? That you'll have students going through a very troubled situation and scenario 186 days a year. And teachers and administrators will take time, days, months, to come up with just the right program. At no point thinking that they haven't actually trained any of their 5,000 employees to actually stop someone from sexually harassing another student, to intervene upon bullying in the appropriate way that a caring adult would. As a matter of fact, it's funny to change the notion of students not being engaged to one of it being their own problem rather than a group of educators that haven't earned the trust of the community and students. Think about it this way. For many children, sometimes the only, and I'm speaking on the United States in particular, sometimes the only place a child will ever see an adult who claims to love them stand aside and watch them harmed will be school. Sometimes the only place a kid or the first place a kid will see a violent incident will be school. Okay? In many countries, unfortunately and fortunately, that can be the case. Lastly, what is throughout these particular documents is largely an apolitical language of safety, symbolized in a discourse that absolves the district of accountability and the responsibility to protect students. Throughout all of the documentation, roughly 53, 54 pages between the board's document, the actual policy, when you look at all of these pages, there is not one mention of protection. There's mention of safety, but no mention of protection. One of the things I'm not going to get to, but there's a lot of also mention of the word trauma and trauma-informed practices. But again, no mention of protection, okay? As a consultant to school districts in my country, I emphasize this element because we do have to build a bond between students and communities, and that should be written into our policy, absolutely. However, it's negligent to identify the realities of human struggle and trauma. Discuss and write into policy initiatives towards safety while neglecting an active agency-oriented approach that involves the notion of protection. Meaning that, how good is it or what good is it for a young 14-year-old, 13-year-old, 12-year-old to be in a building with 100 adults if those adults don't know how to or feel an expectation to protect? My country, this is one of the ways in which you end up with high levels of gang activity in the school, with high levels of violence in the school, and I'm particularly talking about cities like my hometown of Oakland, California, other cities like St. Louis, Missouri, Chicago, Detroit, Michigan, high violence areas, is that what we end up with is not just a lack of practice, but policies that within the language and within the discourse of establishing equity and safety neglect to adhere to their responsibility as educators to protect students and actually implement an agenda that is reflective upon the institution, not just pathologizing of the community. That was 21 minutes, I believe. So with that, I'll just be quiet and conclude. Thank you very much.
How do you say full screen in Polish? Or how do you write it, rather? It's just so that you can see this.
Widok, probably. I hope.
It should be like in the. It should be somewhere there. See, look, you had it here. See?
This one? Yeah,
is that
probably.
Something?
Yeah.
Can we get it any better? No, we can't get it any bigger. Huh? Okay, it's okay. No, that's fine.
Try that. Yay.
Perfect. Thank you. Okay. Well, I've got my clock running too, so I'll try to follow your example. So, just two personal notes before I begin. So, first of all, I'm very happy to be in a room full of sociologists. I'm an economist, so I'm sort of outside my own tribe. And when I was an assistant professor at the University of Montreal, I published a paper in the International Journal of the Sociology of Language. This was many, many years ago. And I got called in by my department chair, who said, never do that again. And now that I'm a department chair, I do whatever I want. The second personal point is that I haven't been in Warsaw in a long time. Just to tell you how long it is, the last time I was in Warsaw, I saw Jaruzelski on television. Father Popiełuszko had just been killed, and I had a lot more hair on my head. Anyway, so what I'm going to talk to you about today is a joint project, which is funded very generously by the Swiss National Science Foundation with two colleagues. So this project involves it's a strange combination of an economist, a political scientist, and a computational linguist. And today, computational linguists are basically computer scientists. So it's three geeks having fun together on something that they've always wanted to do, basically. And I'm going to start off, actually, with a story that I noticed in the New York Times a couple of weeks ago, which was simply on AI. On artificial intelligence, because in some sense this project, this is a four-year project, is trying to do, in terms of interpretation of texts, it's trying to do exactly what this story was talking about what's wrong with AI today. And so the story, which you can see here, is they basically, you know, did a Google search of, you know, did George Washington own a computer, and the best thing that Google's algorithm could come up with was essentially some Guardian story about a computerized portrait of what Martha Washington would have looked like as a young woman. Okay, and another way of putting this, for those of you in my misspent youth, I read a lot of science fiction. Isaac Asimov, The Three Laws of Robotics, right? The robot shall not do harm. AI today doesn't understand what harm is, right? The Google algorithm in an AI is simply based on looking at correlations. Okay? And my job is to look at correlations. I'm an economist, right? But we try to go beyond that, and we try to get to causality. So what is this project? It's basically interpreting text documents. So if you look at that picture up there, if you can see the small print, what I've tried to do here with my colleagues is show you that basically most work in the social sciences over the past 20 or 30 years, when you're looking at moving from policy, so you say, you know, government, for example, says, here's a policy that I want to do. There's some sort of announcement, okay? And we're going to look at a very specific case. then there's interpretation of those announcements, and that interpretation by various talking heads, by journalists, for example. That's what we're going to be looking at. Then we get into the geeky stuff, which is annotation of that, and then we have reaction, like consumers, right, to or investors. Just about everything that's been done in the past 20 years essentially is looking at C, going from announcement to annotation, and to some extent going from announcement to reaction. Okay? So that's the first point that I want to make. Typical example, and I'm talking about the Federal Reserve because this is a whole project on various topics. I'll give you an example of what we're doing on the the Federal Reserve is the central bank in the United States. I'm Canadian, I'm not American, I hasten to add. But the federal, there's also part of this is going to be on the Bank of Canada. And other stuff that's done all the time, you get rid of future there, and then a lot of work in social sciences is basically that relation E. What we do in this project, what we're doing, is relation G. It's basically taking interpretation seriously. And the problem is this is really hard to do linguistically speaking. Going from interpretation to annotation, there's a whole literature on this. This is framing in the media. Okay? So there's a huge literature on this stuff. Just one thing I want to get out of this, you can look up the references, and if you want the bibliography, I'll give you the bibliography, because this is a really vast literature. Most of the stuff that people use to analyze the move from interpretation to annotation is what's known nastily as bag of words. And what's bag of words? It's basically frequencies. Okay? You look at frequencies of words and phrases in texts. Okay? So this is text as data, and you just look at frequencies. But we've been doing this in econ and especially in political science. The economists have got into this really recently. But political scientists have been doing this, and linguists obviously have been doing this for 20, 30 years. This basically is completely brain dead. This is the equivalent of the Google algorithm. Right? This is just looking at correlations because you're just looking at frequencies. Another strand of the literature on going from interpretation to annotation is scaling of things like parliamentary speeches, okay? And looking at the ideological biases of websites and website users. Think of the alt-right in the US today. They too, when they analyze these things, they look for keywords. They look at the frequency with which you see certain words. They look at certain phrases. They go a little beyond it. There's a little bit of stuff now on triples where, boy, we even got a piece of a sentence, right? With a subject, a verb, and an object. And they're starting to inject a little bit of semantics in this, just a little bit. But it's still assez premier balbutiement, as one would put it in French. It's like a baby. It's sort of its baby steps for the time being. And what is the problem? The problem is this problem of interpretation, okay? The problem is interpretation because what you're essentially assuming when you forget about interpretation is that bunches of words are unambiguous. And bunches of words are not unambiguous. You need interpretation to be able to understand. That's what natural language processing is all about. This is not going to work for bag of words. Even some of the semantic work that people have been doing in computational linguistics in recent years on semantic networks, they try to inject a little bit of syntax in there, but even that, they're not doing very well in terms of getting towards interpretation. Another arrow that I showed you earlier, the one going from announcement to reaction. Okay? So this in my subfield, there's a whole bunch of stuff, the Fed says something, how does it affect stock prices? Okay? When you look at this sort of thing, you get bag of words, obviously. There's a burgeoning literature trying to look at complexity, but the measures of complexity in text that are being used, again, at least the way I see this as a social scientist first and an economist second, is it's brain dead. They're measuring complexity, and this is a really good paper by Kothari Lee and Short, by like sentences and the relative frequency of words with more than three syllables. Come on, people, we can do better than this. That's our definition of complexity in the social sciences when we're analyzing text. numerically, we can't do better than this. Tone, right? Tone. Lots of empirical work on tone in text, where people basically look, they have a predetermined dictionary of words which are positive, words which are negative, right? And then you see the proportion of positive and negative words in a text. Come on, we're still in bag of words. It's like glorified bag of words. The one thing which sort of gives me hope for these people is that there's some crude machine learning going on where basically the affect of a sentence is categorized by how it was predicted to be, positive or negative, by some algorithm, by some machine learning. Now we're getting AI which is a little smarter. Okay? But the problem remains, and it's interpretation. So what we need in social science, if we want to do this properly, is we want to borrow the tools from computational linguistics. So what we need is two sets of texts, domain-specific knowledge because of this, because interpretation is really, really hard, right? And we need to be able to combine syntactical and semantic information in the linguistic sense in all sorts of different ways. This, in some sense, is sort of the holy grail of computational linguistics. At least that's what the people who actually know something about it, unlike me, my linguist colleague on the project, tells me. Indeed, you can sort of make, there's the whole literature on summarization, okay? And summarization, basically, you can think of interpretation as sort of a complex version of summarization that linguists have worked on. And there's this stuff on textual entailment. And that's the key thing here is gonna be textual entailment. So for those of you who don't do linguistics, and I learned this stuff like a year ago, okay, this is new to me, but textual entailment, I love this definition, it's basically the relation between two text fragments, a premise and an hypothesis, there should be an hypothesis, where a person reading the premise would infer that the hypothesis is very likely true. That's interpretation. And how have people been addressing this, textual entailment? This is really interesting stuff, scientifically speaking. There are two huge data sets. There's the Stanford NLI, and then there's this multi-NLI. So basically, the Stanford one is a Mickey Mouse NLI, because basically it's just looking at image captions, right? So it's looking at image captions, and then you basically have humans looking at pairs of sentences and basically coding them as being either it entails, it's neutral, or it's a contradiction. Okay? There's a new corpus, the multi-NLI. I mean, they're large, okay? We're not gonna be, in this project, we're not gonna be able to have, half a million sentence pairs. We do have, you'll see. I haven't calculated how many we're gonna end up having. Whoops. So anyway, what we're gonna be doing, I'll leave out this, the geeky stuff. This is also from computational linguistics. Basically, what we want to do in a nutshell is the following in this project. We want to take annotations of newspaper articles. Okay? So I'll show you how we do the annotation. So we're going to take newspaper articles. We annotate them in terms of acts, actors, motives, scope, etc. Okay? So there's various grammars that you can use in the linguistic sense to annotate a journalistic text. We link those journalistic texts, those newspaper articles, are linked to policy announcement documents explicitly, okay? And then what we're gonna do is we're gonna train our friends at EPFL, our computational linguist friends, are gonna use machine learning and deep learning to train an algorithm which will basically then, if our corpus is large enough, be able to generate not the article in the New York Times, okay, well, you know, right, but the annotation which corresponds to an article in the New York Times from an announcement, okay? Well, this is very this is very ambitious, okay, and it depends an awful lot on what our friends at EPFL are able to do. So this is sort of the overall project. All I'm going to show you is half of 1/16th of the project. You do the math, okay? So it's going to be the Federal Reserve in the U.S. and the New York Times. Now we're starting. We're starting on the Wall Street Journal as well. But there's other stuff, and you know, at some point over dinner, I'm happy to talk about this stuff. So what is a policy announcement here? It's a written statement issued by a state agency describing its actions or decision or intentions. Actually, This is no longer the definition that we're using because we also have oral statements. Okay? Interpretation is a statement made about a policy announcement. Okay? So in the case of the Fed, okay, the Fed, let me skip to this next slide. These are all the statements that the program statements that the Federal Reserve in the US makes every year. There's the statement, that's 8 times a year. They're the minutes of the meeting of the Federal Open Market Committee. I'm not a macroeconomist, by the way. I'm a development economist by training. I work in Africa mainly. So this is not my subfield of economics. There are press conferences 48 times a year. There's a monetary policy report. That's in their statutes. There's testimony to Congress or and to Senate 4 times a year. And then there's a beige book, which are the thick reports that they put out. Okay. So whenever they put out one of these reports, whenever one of these reference documents comes out, the next day there's one or two articles in the New York Times and there's one or two articles in the Wall Street Journal. Okay. And then there's all sorts of other stuff going on as well, right? I mean, Janet Yellen, when she was chair of the Fed, would say something, and right away, you know, the Wall Street Journal would jump on her. You know, who likes a Berkeley female governor or president of the Fed, right? That's not the sort of stuff that the Wall Street Journal liked for 4 years. So those are the reference documents, and this was incredibly time-consuming. So we had every single article in the New York Times, okay, from 1999 to 2018. Okay, we did keyword searches. So this is months of work doing these. It turned out, it seems obvious now, but Federal Reserve and policy or inflation and interest rate for that period, for 99, 2010, that's what got us our main corpus. The problem is, that's giving us newspaper articles, right? But you get these newspaper articles, how many of them? Lots, okay? So I'll just skip this. Lots of them. 4,769 newspaper articles. Okay? But this is a really stupid search, right? This isn't AI yet, right? This isn't machine learning. So then we did a human audit to get rid of the false positives. Rather, the false negatives. So how many true positives do we end up having? We end up having about 1,700 articles. That's still a lot of text. Okay, I'll show you what the text looks like. That's 1,700 articles over that period. The interesting thing is that means 105 articles a year, and the articles are published on only 70 out of the 365 days a year. There's very interesting stuff in terms of the days of the week. Indeed, if you go back here, you see one of our search terms that we used also to actually make this search, I don't have time to talk about this, was Wednesday and Thursday, okay? Because that's generally when the articles come out. You learn a lot of useless stuff when you work on a project like this. So when you look at the count of articles, so the blue stuff is our articles, the red stuff are the after auditing by human beings. Anyway, you can do a whole bunch of statistical tests on that. I won't bother you with it. That's the true positive rate over that whole period from 2000 to 2018. Pretty much stable. Okay, varies, but it's stable. It looks IID, and this is what happens in terms of the distribution of the articles, also by month. Okay, so you can see that there's stuff which happens at the end of November, there's stuff which happens in August. So you get these bimodal distributions in certain months. It's very interesting just to look at the data. Some people collect stamps, I collect data. They sort of like to massage it, you know, and cuddle it. I don't necessarily do anything with it, but I just like data, right? Anyway. Okay, so how do we annotate? Okay, because this is still humans, right? So I'm showing you the human side of the project. Okay, then come back and talk to me in a year's time when the machine learning people have done their stuff. So the human side of the project is to specify a grammar. Okay, there are 8 of us working on this. There's 7 of us working on this project in Geneva, and then there's another 4 people in Martigny, where IDIAP, where EPFL, the Polytechnic, which is one of the best engineering schools in Europe, is located. So there are a lot of people. We've had large arguments, huge arguments, as you can imagine, about setting up a grammar. So basically what we do is we take an article, we divide it, we identify standardized sentences, okay? some articles, there'll only be one standardized sentence. This is not a standard piece of terminology. It's something we cooked up, okay? You talk to, scratch a linguist, he or she will not tell you standardized sentence. That's not part of her vocabulary, okay? So a standardized sentence has to be a sentence in which there is an explicit reference to a policy document, okay? Otherwise, if it ain't got the policy document, it ain't a standardized sentence. That's why it has to be standardized sentence goes together with reference document. And then each of us spends an awful lot of time going through each newspaper article, identifying an actor, if it's attributed to someone, if they're specifying evidence, what is the motive, the scope, and a specific act. Okay, so this sounds all very theoretical. I'll show you an example. And what do we do it in? It's not Polish, it's Baltic, so it's a little sort of north of here. It's a company which produces a piece of software which is actually, it's getting better. I think we're one of their best customers. It's called TagTog. And it's a wonderful piece of software. We looked at everything that was available on the market in terms of annotating text, and TagTog is really, really good, and it's getting better. And for those of you who are geeks who do computer science stuff, the output of the annotation, what you want is something which is called a JSON file. It has nothing to do with the Argonauts. That's why they took that name, but it's a JSON file. So what does a text look like? This is a typical article, okay? Now you probably can't see much from back there, but when you see the light green is a standardized sentence. Then when you have blue, okay, the blue, that's a reference document. Some of these reference documents are not in that list that I get. Like, there's a news conference, which was an ad hoc news conference that you see there, like in the fifth line. Okay, that's the reference document, and this is all set up with hyperlinks. Okay, because then what we're going to give the people in Martigny, the EPFL people, the computer science geeks, we're going to give them all this truckload, these 1,700 annotated texts with all the hyperlinks to and all of the policy documents. And then you have things like it'll be scope. That's like Wednesday, the dark green, right? It's Wednesday or over the remainder of 2017. And then you have actor. Most of the time, the actor is fed. You see in the orange, you see that's the actor. Then the act is going to be something like raised its interest rates or raised its interest rate target. That's the act. The attribution is in pink. It's not because it's Yellen. Yellen was not the chair of the Fed for all of these years. It just we put the attribution. So Yellen there is in pink. Or sometimes it's not a person, it's a committee. It's the Central Bank's Policy Committee. Okay. So this takes a lot of time for every article. And actually, it isn't that we have 1,700. We have our 1,700 articles coded by 5 different people. Okay. So you do the math. Okay. I'm an economist. I'm not good at math. Then what does this... what does this file end up looking like? Because this looks nice and pretty. That's what a JSON file looks like. That's the pretty version of a JSON file. And this is like the first 3 lines of the file you just saw. Okay? And then if you want to see the geeky version, that's what it looks like. Okay? So that is an annotated, it's in JSON format, it's a JSON file, which basically takes a text. And what's important here is that basically what we're injecting into this, we're coding it in terms of entailment. Okay? So we're getting at interpretation. We're not looking at frequencies of words. We're not looking at frequencies of phrases. We're not just doing threesicles, right? You know, like a subject, verb, object, right? We're actually putting entailment in there. The third ingredient that then goes into this with what's going to be done with the machine learning algorithms is contextual knowledge, okay? Contextual knowledge about monetary policy. Okay, that's the third thing you need to do this sort of thing. I have other examples here of coding. I don't have time to get into this in detail. But anyway, this is how we're going after this holy grail of going basically getting a machine to take a policy document. Right, to take a policy announcement and to write us, basically what we want the machine to learn how to do is to do a code like this. Okay, is to give us that JSON file And the JSON file can then be turned into sort of plain, simple English. Okay. So that's what we're doing right now. So rendez-vous au prochain épisode. Come back for the next episode if you're interested in this stuff. Thank you for pretending not to fall asleep. I know I'm what's standing between you and dinner, right? So this is a very uncomfortable position to be in. And that's my email if you prefer WeChat. I work a lot in China also. I'll give you my WeChat, or you can scan my WeChat QR code. That's the way. In China, people no longer actually exchange cards as they used to. You just scan your phone. With the WeChat WeChat code. Anyway, thank you. And I took 24. I didn't do as well as you did. I took 24 minutes. No. I did my best.
So, do you have questions in relation to these two wonderful presentations looking at the language of politics?
Thank you for keeping us thinking here at the end of the day. Where did our economist colleague go? Just wondering if you and your colleagues have a pool going on whether it's going to take the machine longer than it took you all to learn linguistics and other things. I mean, do you have a calendar for when you're hoping to have the machine doing the work that it took you all this long to do? Doing it. Okay. Okay. Thanks. I had a quick question also for the professor, Derek. If some people would say a way to protect students in schools is for the teachers and others to have weapons, to carry guns. What is your response to that?
working now? There we go. Okay. So my question is for our first speaker. First of all, just thank you very much for what I found a very compelling talk. I'm going to ask the question, and then I'm going to sort of nuance it just a little bit. And now it's not working anymore. Get an algorithm for this? Anyway, so my question is, to what extent are you seeing student-led activism against this kind of, against the policies, against the implementation, it's not working again, acting again, oh, that's fine, I can project my voice. So to rephrase, question then context. So the question is, to what extent are you guys seeing student-led activism against the policies, against the implementation, and against the existing conditions at schools? And the context that I'm asking
to an adult. If an adult asks you to do something and you say no, a lot of suspensions came from that. All right, so most folks are not going to immediately protest that because that sounds like a great idea if you're used to seeing kids suspended for just telling a teacher no. The problem is that it's not actually nuanced based on the literature around exclusionary practices. It's not nuanced based on the literature around human development, brain development for you, meaning that it makes perfect sense to not suspend elementary schoolers all the time for defiance. But once you hit the adolescent level, once you hit the secondary level, the ability to stop a student when they're on the way to doing something else can actually lower and minimize your chances of violent incidents. Am I making any sense here?
Yes.
Okay. So, what ends up happening is that because this type of policy is cloaked in this kind of projected notion of altruism and sincerity, it's really hard for communities to come together and decide that it's something harmful. So I think for that reason and a series of other reasons, you're not going to see as much youth activism around these particular policies.
Is there another question?
Yes.
So thank you very much for the session, for the question, for this day. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed this first day as much as I enjoyed it. And we have a second wonderful day. And in between, we have a wonderful event. So I really want something. I started the welcome speech thanking somebody, and you were everybody were aware about all the work she did, and now you already experience one full day with this wonderful organization. So I really want a loud applause for Anna for the organization.
Okay, thank you, Stephanie. Without further ado, I would like to introduce a folk group called Lazurki, because we are dealing with language, because we are dealing with regional languages. They will perform a few songs from different regions of Poland. So a big round of applause for Lazurki.
Hej, przeżrebnickie pola leci sadna, hej, nóżka mi przebi robowy zarła. I obych też tak przebirała, kiedy takie nóżki miała. Hej, jak ta sarna, jak ta sarna. I obych też tak przebirała, kiedy takie nóżki miała. Hej, jak ta sarna, jak ta sarna. Hej, na zabnickiej miedzy siedzi zając, hej, łoku nockiem swoim pomerdając. Jobyk też tak pomerdała, kiedyk taki łogr miała. Hej, jak ten zając, jak ten zając. Jobyk też tak pomerdała, kiedyk taki łogr miała. Hej, jak ten zając, jak ten zając. Tak nie widział takiego lenia, jak ta Maryna, co ma być moja. Dobrego rodu, pięknego chodu, robić jej nie chcę, umrę od głodu. Dobrego rodu, pięknego chodu, robić jej nie chcę, umrę od głodu.
Świeci miesiąc, świeci z wieczora do rana. Nie mogę zapomnieć, nie mogę zapomnieć mojego kochania. Nie mogę zapomnieć, mój Boże jedyny, mojego kochania. Tam się zachmurzyło, gdzie zaświtać miało. Tam moje kochanie z wiatrem uleciało. Tam moje kochanie, mój Boże jedyny, z wiatrem uleciało. Z wiatrem uleciało. Popłynęło wodą.
I just want to thank children in Polish, sorry. Bardzo dziękujemy, że przyjechaliście do nas na konferencję międzynarodową Międzynarodowego Stowarzyszenia Socjologii. Myśmy wszyscy cały dzień mieli tremę straszną na naszych wystąpieniach. Wyobrażam sobie, że wy też mieliście tremę, ale wspaniale zaśpiewaliście. Bardzo, bardzo wam dziękuję, że znaleźliście czas, żeby pokazać gościom z całego świata, jakie piękne polskie piosenki i tańce są w naszym kraju. Bardzo wam dziękuję, dzieci. Thank you. Do you want to have a little dance with them or not? Okay. Would you like to learn a few steps of a Polish dance before pierogi time, or do you? Please say yes. Okay. Okay, so. I take this away. Okay. It's a revolution. Okay. Okay.
Kalina, jak się nie wstydzisz, to zapraszam.
Okay.
Okay. Maybe pary, czyli poproszę.
Could you find a pair? Don't be shy. It's a good conversational starter for dinner. Come on, find a pair. Find a pair. You can also pair up with children. You can pair with each other also. Okay. Oh. Thank you. Okay, so what do we do? Look at Kasia, the manager of this beautiful group. Word at this time.
First part, we are
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, but this is hard. I want to learn to use sync for this music. But this word is very hard and so please you repeat for me, okay? Owczarzyczek.
Owczarzyczek.
Nasz.
Nasz.
Wygnał owce w czas. A ja za nim, ze śniadaniem, a on uciekł w las. So please again, owczarzyczek nasz wygnał owce w czas. A ja za nim ze śniadaniem. A on uciekł w las. And we are owczarzyczek nasz wygnał owce w czas. A ja za nim ze śniadaniem, a on uciekł w las. Okay, so please, I play music and we are dance last time.
That's what I'm doing.
Group wishes us tasty pierogi that we're going for to the bar filmowe. So who knows where it is, please go. Thank you very much, Kasia, and thank you, Lazurki!
Thank you so much. It's L-A-Z-U-R-H-I.